Cool.
We have audio live. They hear us now talking.
Oh, that's just, that's scary.
Is that your cursor scary. In the outline?
Yeah. See how Google Docs work?
That's, I love that.
Awesome. Oh my gosh. I'm schooling you.
And let's see. Here we go. Oh wow, I have two chats up. I'm gonna close that chat. Chat is in the middle of us now. All right, what is up, ladies and gentlemen? So, as you guys know and are aware, tonight it is me and the bum to my right.
One of those sides.
This guy over here. No, I'm this guy over there. He's there. That's Fractal Josh.
That's me.
Hopefully the stream doesn't lag too much, which it will, and that's okay.
Oh yeah,
because it's doing it right now. I see it. It's okay.
It is what it is.
Yeah, that is true. It is what it is. So, guys, as I was mentioning before, tonight is all about how people like me and people watching this chat can contact retailers, get product, just general things to do and not do. So, first, let's start off with a little bit about Josh, because I'm pretty sure that a lot of people in here know who Josh is, but let's hear from the man himself.
Yeah, so that's scary. Let's see here. So basically, the way it started was, I was a boutique system builder way back in the day. Did that for about 9 or 10 years on my own business. So I worked the tech side from that aspect. That's where I got to know a lot of my industry contacts, got to work with a lot of different companies. Then after that, I decided to sell my business and get out of it. So when I was doing that, basically, I had to fill my tech addiction. So I went into more of a hardware reviewer role, just kind of more as like a hobby. So I've experienced it on that side. And then now, obviously, I am currently a VP of marketing for Fractal Design for North America. So I've worked that side of it. So that's, I guess, where a lot of my... I don't want to call it expertise, but a lot of my views come in is just from me having to deal with multiple sides of the industry and having to see how each section works and be in each section.
Very nice. So you have a vast knowledge when it comes to hardware and all that good stuff.
Vast or some other four-letter word.
Something like that. Nice. Mm-hmm. So let's get this out of the way real quick. We will be taking questions from chat. Hopefully they pertain to what we're talking about. So if you have questions, make sure that you at both me and Josh in the chat so that way we can see it. Because if as many people come in as I think they're going to come in, chat's going to be going pretty crazy. So I highly suggest that you just at both of us so that way at least we'll see it. And he's making some moves over there.
So I do.
And let's get some things out of the way. Obviously, Josh is not going to give out any like contact information. No, he's not going to give you any information for anyone at Corsair or anything like that. So, if that's a question, please don't ask. Like you should know better. So,
you'd be surprised, but hey, I get it a lot.
That is true. All right, so let's see. We got that. Okay, so do you want to start off?
Sure. I guess the other thing is, obviously, I cannot talk about products that may or may not be in development, blah, blah, blah.
Oh, yeah,
so that'll be the next thing. So if you're asking about the R6 or whatever, I'll just ignore it like I usually do. Mm-hmm. So I guess some of the things to kind of get across, I'm going to try and keep this pretty open and pretty casual, is kind of to give you some insight as far as a vendor, what our goals are originally. And hopefully if you approach it from that standpoint, it might make figuring out your approach a little bit more, I guess, tactical. You know what they want, so you can try and give that to them. So, you know, first and foremost, we want to get positive visibility for our products. We want to have, you know, not just to say like, oh, we want, you know, reviews that say our products are great, but positive in a general sense where it's either well-promoted content or it's content that is done well, something that shows off the product in its ideal usage scenario or something like that. And then next thing would be like, we want to reach as many people as possible. So obviously that's where you see, you know, guys with large audiences usually pull the first review samples, guys like Linus or stuff like that. just because they have a broader reach. We want to grow brand recognition, so it's not always about an individual product. Sometimes we may have, like, somewhat of a marketing campaign where it's trying to grow the recognition of a brand or of a product in a certain area, but a lot of times it's the whole brand itself. And then we're always trying to reach new markets and new niches, right? So, you know, if you are in a segment of the market that you think is either underserved or often overlooked by the larger tech media in general, that's a pretty good hook that you can have. You know, you say that maybe you work on the HTPC space, and that's something that most people don't really focus on as much, or something like that. That's something you always want to kind of bring to the table or bring to the attention of the people that you're dealing with.
Makes sense. So
yes.
So let's say someone new wants to start reviewing product, but they have nothing to do. What would you say for someone that is brand new, just starting, they just made their channel, they have, you know, no subs, no nothing? What advice would you give them?
So basically, if you're walking into it blind, the biggest thing I can suggest, and this is going to sound really lame, but use the official forms of contact. Go to their website, see if they have like a contact us page or something like that. And generally they will. And generally they'll have either a submission for request to review, or, you know, like, for example, on our website, if you go to the contact us page, there's a drop down menu for the type. And it's like, you need, you know, technical support, sales information, press and marketing. I think another one's like sponsorship requests, and then, you know, product suggestions. So pick that and start there. The reason for that is there's a couple different factors. First of all, many companies, especially the larger ones, have very strict regimens on how stuff is done. And that's kind of like your initial entry point into the company or into the system. Some of the larger companies use CRM, which is like customer relationship management software. So it might be to the point where it's fully automated. And if you don't start on that step, you're never in the system. You know, your email is just poof, doesn't go anywhere. And for us, it's important because that's kind of the first filtering point, right? That starts routing it directly to you. For example, we'll get requests on Facebook of, you know, hey, how do I contact you related to do reviews? And the first thing that we reply on Facebook is use our contact page. Because if for no other reason, what it does is it delineates it by region. So if you're in France, it goes to the team that handles France. If you're in, you know, Asia Pacific, it goes to our APAC team. That's where it starts. Because obviously, if you're in APAC, I can't get you a sample. I don't handle that region. I'm not going to ship an R5 from California to, you know, Taipei. So.
Oh, man.
Yeah, I know. As much as you would think cases are incredibly cheap to ship, being big and heavy and stuff like that. But the other thing is, a lot of companies have pretty strict policies too. Like they want to track this stuff. They want to track multiple things, right? They want to track, see if they advertised, if they did a project, if they did something like that, did it work? And a lot of times that comes from initial point of contact. So if you're contacting through their website, then they know, okay, we did something that drove people to this page. This page is effective, or this is where the initial contact with the company came from. Another thing, do not spam every single address you can find for the company.
That so happens. That's to what me. I'm doing wrong.
Yeah.
Damn it.
I'll tell you, it happens to me and it pisses me off. I mean, you know, so the first thing is my odds of helping you out if I'm pissed off are pretty much zero. And it may sound like I'm being like elitist, but the problem is, if you imagine it from our side, and within 15 minutes, you get the same carbon copy email from five different departments, they're irritated because my tech support guys are like, hey, we're trying to help out people that had a problem with their case. Why am I getting some guy asking me for a review sample? Because then they have to stop, send it to me, and then now I've got five copies of your letter asking for a review sample. It's the same as like calling somebody five times in a row or hitting the doorbell five times in a row. You can imagine how irritating that gets, because not only did I just get pinged five times, there's also the fact that you've now, you know, pinged five other, you know, departments that have absolutely nothing to do with your request.
Yeah.
So for them, it's kind of like, what am I doing with this? Like, if you're going to a nice restaurant, you don't ask the valet how well the steaks are cooked, right? I mean, he's parking your car. That's what he does. So it's that same sort of mentality. And then it's harder to track, because if those other people do reply to you, now you might have two or three different departments all separately replying to the same person, thinking that they were the only person that was contacted. And then you get into a situation at some point in time that's going to come up and people are going to be like, okay, so three of us spent X amount of time all on the same issue separately. And again, it doesn't look good for you.
Yeah. I can imagine, because I don't think anyone wants spam of any kind, honestly.
Yeah, and that's basically all it is. I mean, and I understand the eagerness to like, God, I just want to reach somebody somehow, but it's like, you know, it's a difference between knocking on a door and throwing a brick through the window, which, you know, you might get their attention with the brick. Do you think they're going to be really happy when they open the door? No.
Very true. And so, and people also don't realize how many emails you guys get a day also.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're spamming it, then they're just going to be like, yeah, no. Yeah. Nope.
You go in the Nigerian prince file is what there happens there.
But so. he needs your money to get his money out of the bank.
Well, I sponsored him. That's why he has that money.
I wish I would.
I try. So let's see here. So another thing is, the other thing is people in other departments usually can't even help you. You know, for example, my tech support guys cannot send you a case unless you bought one and you broke it. You know, it's like that's outside of their area of responsibility. So even if you do reach them, all that's really going to happen is they're going to forward it on to somebody else who then is now getting pummeled two or three different times.
Yeah, that's not
And that's the thing. It comes down to like if you're wanting something from somebody, the last thing you want to do is irritate them because, I mean, like any situation in life, they're going to be a lot less likely to help you. And then the other thing is a lot of times, especially in big companies, some of those teams don't even talk to each other. You know, the person that's running the Twitter account is not the same person that's running the Facebook account, is not the same person that's running the YouTube, is not the same person that's running the website, so on and so forth. They might not even be in the same state or same country. Okay. So then the odds of them even talking to the other person, especially if they get 50 of those a day, it's just like, okay, file it, you know, boot it, no one cares. Mm-hmm. So like I said, use the official forms of contact. There's usually a primary reason for that. It allows us to track things. Mm-hmm. And let's see here. It's the same thing as like, when you go into the social media, it's a conversation, right? Like, for the most part, and I know, you know, Paul's hardware might be a different story when he's talking about the problem he had with his audio on YouTube, but it's like, a lot of the times, they're limited in what they can do. You know, Twitter's kind of there to answer questions, maybe funnel it to somebody else. But, you know, another perfect example is if you go to Amazon, you know, you don't try and place your entire Amazon order through Amazon's Twitter account. You go to Amazon's web page, and that's where you fill it out. Maybe you have a question, you go back, and you hit them up on Twitter. Let's see here. Other things, give them a reasonable amount of time to respond. Again,
that's a good point, because Kelly Pick just asked in chat, at what point do you send a second request, a month or longer?
17 minutes. That's the golden rule.
17
minutes. If it's any of my competitors, it's every 17 minutes. You just want to ping the hell out of them. Now, for me, and this is going to kind of depend, and this is kind of the overall watershed here, right? Like, these are my opinions. They're not universally applicable. They're generally kind of like best practices. Certain people have certain preferences, but, you know, for what I do, it's pretty common because I know a lot of my competitors, and we talk a lot, and, you know, we'll share stories. So, I'd say no less than a week, like no less than a week, because say if I get yours on Monday, mm-hmm. you know, assuming that I had nothing else to do that day, you know, it's like, even if I could arrange everything and blah, 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 I'm probably not going to reply to you right away that day. It's like, if I'm doing my due diligence, I'm going to hop in and check out your website.
Do some research.
YouTube channel. Naturally. Yeah, do some research. See if it's worth it. And then I'm going to proceed from there. So it's not always like, you get an immediate response. Sometimes I do that. You know, it all depends.
Because for you guys, it's more of an investment than anything. Because when you send someone something, and this connection is pissing me off so much, because when you send someone something, you're not getting anything back directly as a return. There's no money exchanging. You're sending them something, they're sending you something. You have to wait for that, you know? So you can't just...
Well, and that's why it's called return on investment, right? Because you are investing. You're not purchasing right away. It's like... We're giving you the product, hoping that the return is usable content, reach to a new market, somewhat a brand ambassador. I don't mean to say it in a way of like you go around toting the flag, Fractal's great, but that at least what you say is correct. And I'll kind of get into that in a little bit. But, attention to detail is a big part of it. If you do come in guns blazing, nailing every single Facebook account and email address you can find, and you're trying to preach to me about how great of a reviewer you are and your attention to detail, and then I say, we have a contact form on our website that you didn't fill out. You know, my view of your attention to detail has dropped pretty markedly. Mm-hmm. And then in the back of my mind, I'm like, okay, well, if this guy or girl goes through their review and misses key features, or worse, puts them in and gets them wrong, like, that's actually going to be a detriment now to my product. Like, if you come in and say, review the R5, and you're like, oh, it's good, and blah, 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 you say everything right, and then you're like, yeah, at MSRP is for $259. Okay, wow, that's like $130. That's like 200% markup. You've now actually done damage to me as opposed to helping me out. Because it's just like anybody that reads a newspaper, right? When they have the retractions printed on page 5, bottom subcolumn, it could have been a first page story. They screw up. The follow-up is rarely ever seen. So if you put something wrong in your review, I'm kind of at a loss, because I can't really jump in and correct it, because I just look like a vendor that's pissed off about a bad review or trying to fix the review or whatever. Mm-hmm. And even if you place your redaction in it, generally that comes a day or two later when 80% of the views and 80% of the eyeballs on it have already happened. So
yeah,
you kind of want to put your best face forward. It's somewhat like a job interview, not to overly dramatize it. But.
Well, no, it really is, though, because you're pitching yourself to them, basically, and then you, if you're a decent company, I guess you could say, you are going to go and do your research and see if it's viable for you to send them whatever it is that they're asking for or anything like that. So it kind of is like an interview, if you would think so. Think like that, I should say.
Yeah, and you know, the thing is, like I said, there's a difference between persistence and annoying. And I think everybody has their own threshold for that and what that is. But like I said, I would say no more than a week. You know, obviously, if you do follow up, the email shouldn't be, why the hell didn't you respond to my last email? You know,
More than a week, but no less than, like, because I can see someone be like, well, I email them the next day.
Yeah. Well, you'd be surprised. There's been people, I've had people light me up on Twitter for not responding. And then it's like, okay, my level of wanting to respond to you now is even further, you know, down. Because the thing is, what I've seen in the past, honestly, is the people that are the biggest bark at the beginning of, I want something, I'll get it to you, I'll get it done right away. Those are the people that disappear. They get your product and the review never shows up.
Yeah.
It shows up 3 months late, you know, or it's inconsistent, or you can tell they did it at the last minute. So, I mean, those are things. Just, you know, kind of carry yourself professionally. Just, you know, kind of however you'd reach out to someone you don't know.
Very nice. Let's see. Right nut. No, I'm sorry. Giving nut. Asks, what if I haven't done reviews and I want to start doing them? How do I do that? Getting review samples if you don't have a background.
Okay, if you don't have one, the biggest thing to realize is nobody wants to front your business for you. You know, if I'm going to be cold and hard and mean, most people out there don't care if you succeed or if you fail, because they only care when it reaches a certain point, and that's whether you're reviewing, going to school, anything like that. You know, they want you to put the legwork in, because if I'm going to invest in you, you've got to invest in you first. Mm-hmm. And now that I can back out of the whole badass mentality there, the biggest thing is if you don't have, you know, I guess if you don't have experience reviewing stuff, most vendors are probably not going to want you to cut your teeth on their product, you know. Yeah. Because if you're figuring out what you're doing and you do something wrong, or you do a build and it's really crappy, or, you know, for all intents and purposes, how can you really review a case if you've never reviewed a case before? And that's kind of a catch-22, right? Like, how can you talk up the good or the bad if you don't have a basis of understanding for it? Now, he may also be referring to, what if I don't have published reviews? And for that, what I can tell you is just start reviewing stuff that you already own, you know, because it's going to help you. It's going to get you in the mindset of how you look at a product, how you digest it, you know, what features you like, what you don't like, how do you look at it objectively? Like, hey, maybe I don't like this one widget or whatever on this product, but that's me. Somebody else might see a lot of benefit in that, you know. And that's what I would say if you, like, your low cost startup, is really kind of review the stuff that you have around, stuff that interests you. I mean, it's going to be best to have stuff somewhat comparable to the things that you're going to be asking for. I mean, don't show me a review of a car carburetor and then come at me asking for a case. I mean, they're not really that close together, right? But you know, I think as long as you have a portfolio, that's going to help. And that's what you want. You want to show that, A, you can do this. Because especially if you're doing YouTube, there's a lot of stuff there. Especially people like, hey, I'm just starting my YouTube channel. I want, you know, a case. I want to do a review. You know, it's like, if I don't see any videos published, I'm like, do you know how to shoot? Do you know how to edit? Do you know how to light? Do you know how to upload? You know, all these different things that go into it that are regardless of your ability to even review the product. It could be like, oh, you get it and like, oh, my camera died, or I'm not good at editing and I didn't get it up. I mean, these are all things that I've heard.
Or they just don't put a video up.
Yeah, and the video never goes up and time and time and time passes. So, you know, I mean, I think that the big thing to remember is, you know, show that you've already put some skin in the game if you want somebody else to do the same thing for you. Like, if you want me to send you a $120 case plus $30 in shipping, you know, make sure that you're showing me that you've put at least that much time and effort into what you're doing. Not like, hey, once you send me this, I'm going to buy a camera and I'm going to do this. It's like, you know, I appreciate the goodwill gesture, but there's a lot of things I'm going to do too that I haven't done yet that I thought I would have done by.
So, okay, we got a lot of questions.
Okay, how about we go through and grab some questions, because I got kind of an outline for you guys, but I mean, I don't need to keep you hanging on till the end. We'll probably hit a lot of them with just the questions.
Okay, so let's see. A good question that I saw was, what about
why is Josh so beautiful? I mean, that's a given. I wake up in the morning and it's this.
Please don't feed his ego. It's big enough already. I'm surprised he can get his head through the door.
Yeah, it is difficult.
A good question is from Reviews by Gary. He says, what about purchasing a product from a company and doing a review first before asking about more products?
That's always helpful. You know, again, it basically comes down to showing that you have some interest in it, that it's actually going to develop, that the review is going to develop. And it also shows that you know what you're doing. I mean, if you're a photographer and you're looking to get a job, you don't show up with no pictures, right? I mean, that's part of your interview, is your portfolio, the photos that you've done in the past, showing that you have an ability to do what you want to do for them. And instead of getting, you know, paid in a job, you're getting kind of paid in product. Because most of the products that you get, you generally end up keeping, at least with cases, because cases, I mean, we never take them back. A, because shipping, you ship it two or three times, you paid for the case.
Oh, yeah.
The second thing is, you know, if I ship it to, say, Greek, and he reviews it, and say he manages not to scratch something or mess something up when he's building his system in it to do the review, takes it all apart, forgets to put a motherboard standoff back in the box, ships it off to, you know, Paul, I'm apropos, and then Paul's review, it's like, this thing didn't come with enough motherboard standoffs. It sucks, you know. But, yeah, so buying the product is a good step. I mean, obviously, it shows that you're somewhat committed. You know, it kind of goes in line with the whole, you know, if you already own something, review it. It's obviously, it's not a guarantee. But, you know, it definitely does show that you're putting the effort in. Because one of the other things that we face on our side is, you know, there is no magic case fairy or product fairy. So it's like, damn, all this stuff. I know. I might look like a case fairy, but believe it or not, I'm not. And the thing is, like, we have to pay for that, right? Mm-hmm. So that case costs us money to ship out. Obviously, the material costs, what we bought it for, blah, blah, blah. The other thing is, you know, I have to turn in reports on where my reviews are at, what's going on. So obviously, if I send it out to someone who I think isn't going to perform, I don't then want to have to make excuses for that person for the next 6 weeks internally and why that review's not turning up.
Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Makes sense.
So again, all that, you know, you're building your credibility, right?
That's true. And it's just like you said before, which I don't remember what I was going to say just now. Okay, cool. There was another question. Let's see. I have a full-time job like Jay at the moment. Mm-hmm. Only so much vacation time. What's the best event to attend to network and make contacts? That's a good question, actually.
Again, you know, I'm going to assume that this is all based on the tech industry, right? It really kind of depends. The thing is, and I think we were talking about this on a gaming stream the other night,
yeah,
is that with events, it's whether you know how to work them or not. You know, you can show up at CES, but if you don't know anybody there, it's probably not going to do you that much good. For the most part, the people that are running the booths and on the show floors are honestly very low-level people.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're even interns or they're hired locally, especially with the larger companies. You're not going to run into like their, you know, their head of sales or marketing or something like that.
And you need people skills too.
Yeah, and if you do, it's going to be more happenstance than, you know, it's kind of the same thing. It's like going to Vegas, right? Like going to Vegas with $1,000, I'm going to play roulette. Okay, man, you got odds. It might happen, it might not. For tech, though, CES is good just in the sense that obviously all the tech media is there. Mm-hmm. It's kind of becoming less relevant for hardware component guys like us because it's getting taken over with, like, you know, cell phones and car electronics and stuff like that. But if that's stuff that you want to cover, then by all means, go.
Yeah.
I would say those events a lot of times are more valuable for networking than for content, because what you see is when an event like that hits, you got, you know, for example, in our segment, you know, Tech Syndicate, Paul's Hardware, Awesome Sauce Network, Newegg, Hardware Canucks, you know, all those guys, Linus, they're all pushing out content about the show. So it's like if you're trying to reach a new audience, they've probably already seen it on one of those 18 other channels that's running video of the same event that you're at. Now, granted, they might be in the suites doing, you know, the kind of the one-on-one tours.
And, laying in bed and talking about hardware, of course.
Yeah, exactly, or perhaps in a hot tub. But, you know, the thing is, it's more about, you know, you can kind of be in your element. I would say CES is pretty good. Mm-hmm. If you're wanting to get into the tech industry, but like you said, Freak, it's about having people skills. Do you know how to talk to people? Do you know how to approach someone and not just sound like you're asking for freebies? You know, do you know how to network with people? Mm-hmm. And those are a large part of what's going on.
Yeah, because if you walk up to someone and you're just like, hi, and you give them a card and you walk away, they're going to be like, throw his card away.
Yeah, you know, you get that, or you get the, hi, I'm so-and-so, check out my website, blah, 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 I want to do this. And it's like, you're going to meet people there. A lot of things probably aren't going to happen there because you're probably one of 200 people that walked up and did that same thing in the span of that week.
Mm-hmm.
So the odds of your card getting lost, I would say it's more important, give them your card, get their card.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
more important. Because I always tell people, too, like when I go to CES, like when I hand them my card, I'm like, do not email me for like 2 weeks. It's not because I'm trying to be a dick. It's like, I'm going to get back from this show on Monday, and I'm going to have, like, A, all the work that I missed while I was out. B, I'm going to have all the people pinging me right away. So it's like, so that you don't get lost in the shuffle, wait like a week or two after the show and then follow up. Hey, we talked it. And then bring up something unique about what you talked about so that they remember you.
Yeah.
You know, it should be like, hey, we met at the, you know, the bar at the Venetian on that Tuesday, blah, 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 or I was a guy that was talking about modded cases and showed you this. You know, you want to be, you know, memorable so that they can put a face with a name and not be like,
I was a guy with no pants on, remember me?
Yeah, like, yeah. Well, that is memorable, that, you know, so you could do that. I've done that. No,
I mean, it's Vegas.
Yeah, that actually probably wouldn't be so memorable in Vegas.
Exactly.
But yeah, you definitely, you want to give them a reason to remember you. Otherwise, the whole face-to-face interaction was kind of, you're back to the website thing, right? Like, you're Joe Blow Anonymous coming at me. They don't remember. It's like, you know, I talked to you at CES. Okay, well, I talked to 8,000 people at CES. To give you guys an idea, last year at CES, I had 52 different meetings in 4 days. So it's like, and that was in a suite with invite-only stuff. So you can imagine, if you're hitting someone on the show floor, I think the first year I did on the show floor, I had 380 business cards. So, you know, the whole, like, hey, we met at CES, it's really hard to remember unless something stood out. So.
Yeah. That's good. Let's see. Another good question is, what's the largest mistake people do when approaching that you've seen for a product?
There's quite a few. You know, one of them is, and this is kind of like, I can totally see how it happens, like forgetting to put any contact information in the email.
Mm-hmm.
You know, now granted, like for us, when it comes through our system, it'll say, you know, I the Greek at blah, blah, blah. You'll have your email in there. You'll be like, hey, I'm running a YouTube channel and, you know, I got this and we got so many views per month and we're going to try and do this. And then, like, they don't give me a link to their YouTube channel. I'm like, and I can understand how it works, like when you're working through it and you're trying to get that email out and you're not thinking about it, you're, oh, crap. But it's like, then I'm kind of like, okay, now I got to email you back to find out if, you know, what your YouTube channel is. And then I might get in that awkward thing of like, then I look at their YouTube channel, now their YouTube channel's crap, or, you know, it's got like 3 viewers or something like that. And you have that awkward, okay, thanks for the info, but no. You know, so and maybe I should dive into something else here. Like a lot of people, it's kind of, you know, I don't have very many followers. I don't get very many views. You know, will people still respond to me? And the answer is yes and no. Mm-hmm. I think that my view on that's a little bit different than other people. For me, it's not so much about sub count. It's about average video views. That's going to be more of an indication of how much visibility my product is going to get if I send it to you. If you're averaging, say, 100 views per video, right? Mm-hmm. And, but you have a sub count of 20,000 subs.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter. You got 20,000 subs. You're averaging 100 views per video. That's what I'm probably going to get if I send you something. And on the flip side, I've seen people that have very low sub counts and get a very high ratio of subs to overall video views. Mm-hmm. To give you an idea, like on YouTube in general, you should expect, or at least with the people that I advertise with, I think the overall prevailing average is sub to view ratio is about 15%. So that means if you have 100,000 subs, then you probably have about 15,000 average video views. The people that I work with generally are around the 20% mark.
Yeah.
Right? So, you know, 20,000 out of 100,000. Mm-hmm. And then there's always going to be some viral video that flares up. And, oh my God, look at this. I got 300,000 views. And
Always.
Yeah. And then there are other options. There are other, I guess, aspects of that. There are certain companies, I'm not going to name names, that have close to 100,000 subs and their videos get like 300 views.
Oh, yeah. 400 I remember views. That.
And it's like, you know, so that's why sub count doesn't mean as much to me. Other people, it might. You might be dealing with people that they maybe have quotas. They may have a directive inside their company. It's like, we do not sponsor anything below right or wrong. That might be what it is. And that's where you have to realize you will get rejected.
Yeah.
Deal with it and move on. It's going to suck. Now, on the flip side, our Facebook page currently has 126,000, 127,000 followers. Like, I started that and it was at zero. And you have that awkward phase of, hey, come check out Fractal's Facebook page. We have 7 followers. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like everybody goes through that. It's like going through the puberty of your business, man. It's like there's no way to go from 0 to 10,000 overnight. And if you do, it looks really fake. So it's not going to help you.
Very, very fake.
I've had people come to me with the, oh, look how many Twitter followers I got. And it's like I look at it and I start paging through their page. And then I see, like, they're sending out tweets to people about, hey, here's where I bought my Twitter followers. Like, you just came at me selling me your audience thinking that I'm not going to take the time to do the research. I hit page down 3 times and I find out you bought those Twitter followers. Okay.
Yeah.
Peace out. Gone. Because they're worth nothing to me now because those people don't care about what you're tweeting about.
Let's see. Rage asks, how much content do you think you should have before asking vendors to send you items? 1 good video? 5, 10? Or is it more about the quality of the content and the potential the vendors see in you? That's a...
Well, I know Rage. His first step should be, as long as his face isn't in the video, he's miles ahead. He should be good.
And as long as he's not showering.
Yeah, exactly. Like you're in the middle of a stream.
In the middle of a stream.
Honestly, it's going to vary for different people. You don't want to show your house for sale and have just like a freaking plastic folding chair in the living room, right? You want to look populated. It's kind of the same thing with your YouTube channel. Again, there's going to be some flexibility here. There's going to be some companies that just look quick, ooh, look at the page, and then boom, there you go. There are people like me that research this crap, and I look like, wow, you got 27 videos. They all posted within the last week. Okay, that looks a little odd. But generally, the more content, the better. It doesn't mean that you have to have 50, but the more content you have up there, the more stuff I'm going to have to look through. It's going to show more persistence on your part. Like, this guy didn't just quick doctor up 3 videos and try and go get a case. He's done, you know, 2 cell phone reviews. He's done this, he's done that. I've supported people that were, I think, incredibly small, but I liked the way their videos looked. There are people like, okay, for example, Tech Clash, Spurkowski.
Oh, yeah.
Kid's like 15, right? And he sends me like an email like, oh, can I have a case and blah, 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 and I'm 15. And, you know, that seems to be one of the things that like younger people do is like right away you kick the age out there. I'm 15. Don't start with that. I don't care how old you are. I mean, you know, it's like if anything, that makes me start questioning things right off the bat. If you go, I'm 15 and.
Yeah.
And I'm not knocking Spurkowski at all. So anyway, so I check out his site and I already had this mental image in my head like, okay, it's going to be this shaky cam crap. And I'm looking at it and I'm like, holy crap, like kid's actually doing some pretty good video on it. And it's like, he doesn't have the largest following base on the face of the earth, but I don't care. I mean, it's like the actual video content was well done. He did some camera tricks, like he did some pans and stuff like that. He even took some stills and then kind of zoomed in around it, but it looked professional.
Yeah.
You know, and the thing is, if my product's going to be in your video, you know, I'm going to be associated with you in some way, shape, or form, right? At the end of the day, I'm hoping to reach your audience because you're a trusted advisor to them. They're watching you because they believe what you say, and they're basing their purchasing decisions off of what you say. Mm-hmm. So if you come out looking like Joe Shit the Rag Man, you know, and it's like you got your bong on the table next to my cake, like, yeah, I'm not going to send you stuff, right? It's like, I don't want to be associated with that, because then there's that level of, you know, lack of professionalism. But on the flip side, that does not mean that everybody has to go out there and shoot like Dimitri and have everything like,
oh, dear all God, bokeh. Yeah.
Yeah, or Ebra, because I saw Ebra in the chat. Like, they do awesome work, but it's very intimidating to new guys because it's like, holy crap, I don't know how to do it. You don't have to do that. It's about the content. You know, find your voice. Find what makes you different from the 80 other tech YouTubers out there and stick to that. And you're going to learn as you go on.
Yeah, that is very true. Let's see. What other good questions do we have?
Oh, by the way, if you posted a question we didn't answer, feel free to post it again. It's kind of streaming by a little
bit. Exactly, yeah. My underwear helmet is going to remain where it is. Let's see. All right. Let's see. If you were to send out a product, how many videos do you expect on that one product? Like separate videos for unboxing, review, and something else? Or do you like it better when they all have it in one?
It depends on your channel.
Yeah, that's definitely... I agree.
Well, and I guess this is towards YouTube, right? But I mean, it all kind of depends on what your content is. I don't want my case to fly in the face of what your standard content is. Like, as you can see, the integration to do with Linus, I want it to be something that matches up with your content. Mm-hmm. So if you do unboxing videos, go ahead and do an unboxing video. I mean, me personally, you know, the more content I get, the better. But the flip side is, it's just like event coverage. You're going to take a piece of the pie and you start cutting it up. If you have five R5 videos on your page and say you normally get 10,000 views, what's really going to happen is you're going to have five videos with 2,000 views each as opposed to one with 10.
Yeah.
Because your audience is going to be like, okay, there's the unboxing. I watched that. Okay, I don't need to watch a review and then a separate system build video and stuff like that. Unless maybe you have a unique way of doing it.
That's true.
So for me, generally what I expect is one. I expect one.
At least one.
Yeah, at least one. And it depends. I mean, I'd rather have one well-done video than have like six that are crap or rushed or, you know, don't make sense. Like, I don't want videos for the sake of videos. Yeah. I want stuff that actually has some legs to it and is something that people want to watch.
Mm-hmm. Very true. Very, very true. Death Touch MK says, how do I talk to Factor Design about the product reviews? That's you.
How do you talk to us? Go through our website. Page. Yeah, go to our contact page. That's going to get you in the system routed to the right region. If it's North America, it'll be me. It'll get routed to me. And that's the other thing when I talked earlier about, you know, giving at least a week. Sometimes for us, the person that sorts it gets so many in, they're doing it worldwide. I'll get a batch of emails, like 10 emails in one day from our website that I know came in over 2 or 3 days. So sometimes I don't get it the day you send it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, go through our contact us page.
Nice.
And for most companies, that's true. That's something we touched on earlier. Basically, go through the official contact lines first. Mm-hmm. I got one here. It looks like I've seen this one scroll by a couple times. D33, G33. My question is, if you're a modder, what's the best way to get a vendor interest?
Oh.
Yeah, so I've worked with Bill Owen and a lot of those guys. Again, it comes down to portfolio. The sad thing is most people do not want to, you know, front the cost for your first attempt at something, right? Like, hey, I'm getting into case modding and I want to try it out on your case. Like, you want me to send you one of my cases so you can hack it up while you learn how to do it. And then if it turns out good, I get content. If it turns out bad, then you just hack the crap out of my case. So what I would do, generally, okay, normal scenario, if you come to me wanting me to sponsor a mod or give you a case for a mod, I'm going to want to see a portfolio, either previous mods that you've done. And it doesn't have to be, you know, again, Eber and Dimitri level photography and lights and glowing crap. I mean, that's better. I mean, you know, the best you can make yourself look, that is going to help you the most.
Even trying is worth it at least.
Yeah. It's a lot better than like the vertical, you know, Snapchat, you know, picture that you take on your phone. Like, I've gotten some like that where it's all grainy. I'm like, oh man, I can't really see that well.
Unless you're recording with like a Galaxy S5 and you're doing 4K recording, that's different.
Yeah. So, basically, ideally have a portfolio of your work. That does not have to mean like strict portfolio. Like what works for me is if you have build logs, especially on very popular forums like, you know, BitTech and Modzu and stuff like that, places that are known for, case mod build logs, then go ahead and, you know, send that to me. Like, hey, here's some examples of what I previously did. Because I will tell you, modding is a difficult thing to get sponsored, especially by a case vendor, because for the most part, you're going to take our component and then modify it to the point where it's no longer recognizable and then try and tell people that that's giving me visibility. Mm-hmm. Now, I totally understand why you do it, and I do support guys that do it, but just realize, like, I still need to have some sort of identity at the end of your process, otherwise I lose any of the visibility that you're trying to give me. So that's where build logs come in handy, you know, because then people see the build up to it, right? Like, okay, here's the case, here's what I took out, here's how I painted it. And people love to watch that, like, behind the scenes stuff and then mm-hmm. see the final picture. So, yeah, basically have a portfolio, have previous examples that you've done. And this is something I'm going to touch on later, but I'll bring it up here. If you're trying to go for, like, the whole, I want an entirely sponsored build, like, you know, we supply the case and power supply. I'm talking to Asus about a motherboard and a graphics card. Well, no one wants to do that. No one wants to be the first person in on that, because what happens, it's happened to me like 3 or 4 times. I do it, I send it out, and then a month later, hey, where are we at? Oh, I'm just waiting on the video card. I haven't gotten the video card back yet. And then 2 months, 3 months, 4 months, 5, and then it's one of those things like, okay.
You're just stuck in limbo.
Yeah, now I'm stuck in limbo. Now I got a case out there that you can't really do anything with. And then I usually get the email, okay, I'm changing course. I'm going to try and get this. And it's like, that's all well and good, man. But, you know, it doesn't do me any good. And at the end of the day, it has to do me some good and ideally you some good. This should be mutually beneficial. I give you a case and, you know, I get visibility. You, in turn, get content and hopefully more readers or viewers for your channel. That's where it needs to be mutually beneficial.
All right. So did I call you or did you call me?
You called me.
Do you want to call me?
Sure. Yeah, we can do that. We're taking a little TO.
We're just going to have Josh call me, and then we're going to continue this momentarily. So let me just swap scenes so no one can see the Skype. There we go. So Josh is going to call me. So this, hopefully, I'm guessing that this is what will fix the lag, because the lag is kind of a pain in my ass right now. Hold on. Let's see if this fixes it. So we got 103 people in here, by the way.
Is that pretty good?
That's a it's kind of good. You're a lot brighter now when you pull that cup up, by the way.
I know. I don't know what the hell it.
I don't know.
It's the light of the gods. I'm not live, am I?
Yeah, you are.
Am I really?
Yeah.
Oh, great. Well, so anyway, Paul, I'm apropos such a D-bag. God, that guy.
Well, they can't see you, but they can hear you.
Lemon pound cake, man.
He was talking about that before, lemon pound cake.
Yeah. I saw it. So people of the chat, I am trying to keep up with the questions. I hope I'm doing okay. I see a few in here that I have or have not responded to. See, that covers everything. I either have or have not responded to your question.
Exactly. Data cap in New York. No, I don't have a data cap, thankfully. But I think it's the weather, because we've had really shitty weather recently. So, okay. So there's one question that I keep seeing, and I feel bad because I keep forgetting to ask it. And it was, hold on, Giving Nut again. He says, "What if I'm doing my reviews in English? What if I'm not doing my reviews in English? I don't see much French tech reviewers, and French is obviously his main language. How do you take a look at other language channels?" I think that's pretty.
Okay, so that's the thing, basically. That's where it all gets down into regions. At the end of the day, if I'm going to be flat out blunt, you don't do anything for me personally, because I handle North America. But the thing is, if you do stuff in French, I mean, that's your niche, then hammer that. If you don't see very many other French tech reviewers, you know, then be the badass of French tech reviewers.
Yeah.
You know, especially YouTube, right? You know, it's like, I would argue that perhaps you have, you know, maybe a better shot than like someone trying to hit the English speaking market. You've got, you know, all the guys that are 500,000 subs and above. So, you know, we're 100,000 subs and above and that sort of thing. There's a lot more competition. And that's where, if I can give one piece of advice, if you're looking to do YouTube to make money, stop right now. You're, the odds of making money in YouTube now to any appreciable degree
are not in your favor.
They're not in your favor. It's a supply and demand thing. Everybody wants to have a channel. But it's all about setting your goals. If you want to do it as a hobby and to have fun and maybe to get some, you know, quote unquote free hardware, that's the other thing. It's not free. I mean, ask anybody that has a YouTube channel. By the time you get it, study the product so you know what you're talking about, shoot it, reshoot it, edit it, upload it, optimize it, blah, 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 blah. That ain't free anymore when you spent 10 hours on that video card you got.
Oh, yeah, definitely. If not longer.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Especially when you're new, it'll be longer. Because, like, if you sit down, like, I've sat down next to Austin Evans after we shot a video and watched him, like, sit there and edit it on the couch and it's all hotkeys and flipping around. Same thing with Logan and guys like that. It's like, they can edit quick as hell, and it still takes them a long time.
I'm jealous of people that can edit that quickly because I hate editing. I hate it with a passion.
Well, and then there's people like Matt Philly who can't even edit. I mean,
he can barely talk, so that's fine.
I know. A New York thing. I don't know what that's all about. But
no, he's from Long Island, so he has an even worse accent.
He's like a stuck-up New York guy. But the reality is, you know, you're going to be putting a lot of work into it. So just have realistic goals. I'm not trying to quash dreams here. There is somebody that could start tomorrow and become a huge YouTube star. Mm-hmm. But if you're noticing anything, especially lately, YouTube is not stupid. They see where the money comes in, and they're kind of cracking down on that. So, you know, you're building a house on somebody else's land. They own the land. They can evict you. So just remember that and keep that in the back of your mind.
What about written reviews, asks Punk Poets.
Okay, yeah, Punk was asking that. I think Strider was asking it too. Mm-hmm. You know, for the most part, like all the contact stuff is the same, right? If you have a portfolio, if you have written reviews, you know, link me to your website. Ideally, link me to stuff that's closely related. You know, if you did review another case, even if it's from a competitor, I don't care. I mean, I'll still go in and look at it and see, you know, is it well written? You know, honestly, are the photos well done? They don't have to be, again, professional, but it should be. Like, for example, we presented kind of a difficult scenario, right? You know, black case, black interior is a difficult thing to photograph and get detail out of.
Very true.
So that's what I'm going to look for. Is it, did you take 10 seconds and drape up a bed sheet behind it? Or is your cat cleaning itself in the background of the shot of you, you know, photographing the case? These are all things to kind of weigh in. So basically, put your best face forward, you know, reviews that you're proud of that are either really in depth, or if you write reviews from like a funny stance where it's more of a comical sort of thing, anything that sets you apart from the other 80 people that are trying to get what you're trying to get is going to help you.
Mm-hmm. So what does it cost you? What is a process for you to send someone a case or a power supply for review? Because I'm pretty sure a lot of people are curious about that. Because, like, asking for it's one thing, but when you finally decide, okay, fine, I'll send so-and-so this, what is the process that you had to go through? Because I'm pretty sure no one really knows that.
Okay, so, you know, it might be a little bit different for me since I am the VP of marketing for North America. I generally get a kind of, I don't say I have carte blanche, but I usually don't have to go through as much of, like, a rigid approval process. But it still does have to be justified at the end of the day. So what happens, like when I actually make the choice to send something to someone, it's based on what we have in available inventory, because obviously we have local inventory. If they're brand new products, especially launch products, a lot of times I will get just a certain allocation of them. I have X amount until the container comes over. So let me back that up a bit. What'll happen in product development is, goes through the various product development stages, a prototype or two are kicked out, they look them over, make sure that they are what they want, and then they'll usually run like an initial batch. You know, they'll make X number of them, right? Like an initial production run of however many. And what will happen is we will generally get our primary review samples, our first round review samples, out of that batch. Now that batch also has to satisfy every region that we service. So for example, if we have 10 regions, 100 cases were made, the most you're going to get is 10. Sometimes bigger regions like mine might pull more than smaller regions, but I might, especially on a new case or a new product, I might have a very finite amount that I have. Like, I have this many. And then those are generally flown over. Like, so we don't wait for the container ship to bring them over. Those are flown over. So right away, I'm taking it in the shorts on the cost on that because I paid to fly them over. And that's why a lot of times when you see something come out and you see 10 guys all have the brand new cards or brand new cases or whatever, and then you go to contact them like, I'm sorry, we don't have any. It's bullshit. I saw these 10 guys had them. Like, yeah, those are all the first round review guys. Those are all the ones that had set up ahead of time.
And they've had them for weeks.
Yeah, and then for me, it's like I'm waiting for my second shipment to come in, and a lot of times the second shipment might be the container shipment that's coming into port that Newegg's going to pull stock off of, and you know, NCIX US and Microcenter and all those sorts of guys. So I'm waiting for the boat to come in, basically, and then I get my follow-up review samples from there. So a lot of times you'll see initial publication, kind of a pause, and then you'll see second round reviews going out. But when we send them out, basically they come out of our warehouse, and then I send them whatever. We have to justify the cost on sending the cases to people. Cases are not cheap to ship. Obviously, if you look at the price that Newegg charges for shipping, for example, you'll see that it's going to be cheaper than it would cost you to ship that case to Newegg.
Yeah.
Because obviously they have a large volume discount. So we have to justify that. I also have to justify the cost of the case itself. You know, is this opportunity worth it? So just like when you guys go to buy something, I mean, same sort of thing, right? Okay, is this case or is this power supply worth the money I'm going to spend to buy it? Mm-hmm. That's the same thing we got to do on reviews. I'm basically, I guess in that sense, you could say I'm buying reviews, but that sounds horrible. So it's basically, I'm looking at where do I get the best return?
It's an investment. Buying reviews sounds so bad.
Yeah, you know what I mean? But you guys get what I mean.
Yeah. Let's see. Oh, this is an interesting one. What should we say in an email? I think we kind of answered this before. What should we say in the email that we send out to companies inquiring about product sponsorship? We kind of answered that before.
Well, I can kind of dive into it real quick if you're looking for like the structure of an email. And this kind of goes back to one of the guys on Twitter, and I'll butcher his name. I'll just say his last name is Kirshner. He just says, do you prefer a more relaxed approach or very serious and respectful approach for first interactions? It's like anything else. If you don't know somebody, go the safe road, right? Because you don't know who's going to get it. You might think that, like, you know, hey, Josh, what's up? Signed the stream last night. That's cool. And you send it in our contact page. Seven people might read that before I get it.
Oh, yeah.
So just kind of keep that in mind. Same thing for other companies. If you don't know them, be professional, but do not be buzzword-dropping marketing speak professional. That just makes it sound like you don't know what the hell you're talking about. You know, like you're playing like basically marketing buzzword Mad Libs or something. Like, I would really like to synergize on this opportunity for us to come together.
It's on your order of the day calendar.
Yeah, exactly. See that? And it's just, you kind of get written off. So, I mean, just be professional. Just kind of be upfront. Like, you know, hi, you know, I really like your products. I have a channel or I have a website and I do this. This is my specialty. Yeah, I'd really like the opportunity to review XYZ product. And it's always better if you say a specific product, because if it's like you know, I would like to review some of your products, you know, because here's one thing that we all get the blanket carbon copy email. Hey, I'm a great fan of your company. I'd really like to review some of your products. They seem to be some of the best. Like, when I start reading through and I can see if there's no identifying marks in that email, it's like I'm one of seven people that got this email today. Mm-hmm. The only thing worse is I've gotten them before where they forget to take the other company name out of it.
Oh, awkward. Like, I've had people like,
hey, Josh, I really love what you guys are doing. Fractal's a great company. I sure would like to try some of those Corsair, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, I'll send you over to George. What? Hey, he's with Corsair. I'm not. So, yeah, I mean, just kind of be direct. You know, present yourself in the best possible light. But the opposite side of that is do not write a book. If someone opens an email and sees like 14 freaking pages of text, they're not going to read it.
It's just like when you send out a resume, basically. When you put the cover letter, you want the cover letter to be something that grabs their attention. Mm-hmm. And if it's something that's not going to grab their attention, then whatever.
Yeah, it should include basically professional, what you want, you know, what you're going to do with it when you get it, why you're different, what sets you apart. And then, like, kind of how to contact you or prove a previous performance, you know, like portfolios, websites, YouTube channels, stuff like that.
So
those are the kind of the who, what, where, why, when sort of stuff.
We got a couple good questions. This one should be kind of easy, kind of ish. Mm-hmm. Kelly Tech asks, from dock to dock, how long does it take a container to reach America from China?
That depends. It depends what side of America you're going to. And I'm not a logistics expert, but generally what we figure is it's about 2 to 3 weeks, but the problems that we had in the LA ports with the strikes and stuff like that, you can see boats sitting in the port for 2 months.
Yeah. If you've ordered anything from China, you know, do not expect that in a week or two weeks.
So generally what we say is 2 to 3 weeks, assuming no adverse conditions or whatever. If the boat then gets to the port, gets right into the port, gets directly offloaded, you can expect the container to sit in the port for at least another week or two waiting to go through customs. And then it has to go on a truck, get trucked to whoever bought it, which may take, you know, another day to get there. Then either they directly offload it or they set it there for a while. So, I mean, if you're looking at, like, factory to shelf, I mean, it could be anywhere from 6 weeks to 3 months.
All right. Not bad.
So
Killer Clown J asks, this is a good one, too. He owns a small computer company. He builds, mods, repairs, anything and everything. How does he cut out the middleman? And let's say he wants to just work with Fractal cases. How does he cut out the middleman to just get it from Fractal to him?
Like, buy directly from us?
Yeah, being okay. Some kind of like not a distributor, but you know what I mean?
I know what you're saying. So the short version is, in North America with us, you cannot. The way our business model is set up, we are not allowed to sell direct. There's different tax laws and things like that are in place. So generally what you would do, like, I guess we can't sell direct to end users. To companies, we could, but what you're going to run into is our minimum order requirements. Mm-hmm. So it could be, depending on what you're going after, depending on what your volume is, it could be anywhere from 100 units to a container. It all just depends, and part of that is because you look at the scale of business. Since we're set up to basically supply sales partners such as Newegg and CIX, even smaller shops, Micro Center, even small mom and pop shops, then that's basically how we're set up. One of the realities of that is distribution, which I'm sure he's probably familiar with. Mm-hmm. And distribution is what's commonly known as the middleman. So we sell to distribution, or I should say they buy from us. They sell to other people. We don't have control over pricing. I know people will think that it's like, oh, your case is priced the same at 5 different stores. It's like, well, that's why it's MSRP. It's manufacturer suggested retail price. If we told everybody they had to sell at $110, that's called price fixing, and that's illegal. Mm-hmm. So we make strong suggestions. You know, we say it's like, yeah, the MSRP, you should keep it at the MSRP because that's what we suggest. And these 5 other guys are doing it. If you want to mark it up $10, by all means, you can do that. But people are probably going to go buy from this guy. So the best thing I would say is, if you'd like to get more information on it, and again, that's kind of a blanket answer, go to our website, go to the contact page, and there should be sales inquiry, and fill out the sales inquiry there and at least talk to somebody. I mean, depending on what you want to do, there might be exceptions to it. You know, if you want to do a one-time batch order of something and it might be something that we have in our local warehouse, we might be able to work something out. That's kind of outside my purview. That's on the sales side, but you know, ask. Worst thing that can happen is you get told no.
Yeah, very, very true. So there you go, Jay. You wanted to know, and now you know. Code 10 asks, do charity/nonprofit projects differ your approach from reviewers?
Yes and no. Code 10's in the Marines, right? No, it's Navy. No, what? I can't remember what it is. But so does it change the approach, or does it change how we respond to it? To a certain degree. You know, I think everybody wants to feel like you're doing something good. You want to feel like you're helping people out. It all depends. I mean, at the end of the day, it's like, I would love to give a bunch of stuff away to help people out, but it's kind of hard to run a business on giving stuff away. You know, it's kind of the joke I make in streams a lot. You know, when people are like, hey, can I have an R5? I'm like, yeah, sure, it's sitting in a new egg, go buy it. But the thing is, you kind of have to, I'm sorry, I'm just looking at Code 10's response.
Yeah, I saw Army, that.
Army, whatever. So the thing is, what you really want to do when you're looking at the charities is you want to make sure that they kind of align with whatever your company's principles are from a vendor standpoint. And what you'd find kind of surprising is, like, for example, we're working with Operation Supply Drop now, and something that's very patriotic and very good here can be perceived entirely different on the other side of the world, you know. And when we're a global company, it might be kind of hard to do something like that, right? Where it's like, yay, support our vets. And then maybe we're selling into a country that doesn't like our vets, right?
That's
and
awkward.
So, yeah, and that's the thing where it's like, so I still do what I want to do because I think, you know, it's a whole think globally, act locally type of thing, right? Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think that the charities do carry somewhat of a soft spot because you get to see the good of what you're doing, right? So it's a little bit, it's kind of a cool thing. Plus, I would say at the onset, it seems like less of a gimme, gimme, gimme if it's a charity.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, just being a charity is not going to guarantee anything. So I don't know if that answered your question, Code, but hopefully it did.
Let's see. I just saw a good one. Where is it? Oh, okay. Mystery Fizz asks, just touching on modding again, I'm on a version 2.0 of a built-in monitor side panel mod. Is that interesting to a case manufacturer because it still maintains its form?
Yeah, I mean, the one thing that I don't want to say that I'd never support, but the thing that's very difficult for me to personally justify is like scratch builds, where it's built from the ground up. And I'm like, I think they look awesome, but I'm kind of like, okay, well,
what case did you use?
You didn't use anything. So, you know, you're a badass for doing that, but it doesn't really benefit me. Yeah, I think anything that keeps it, like I've supported some mods where it's like, our case has been pretty hard to recognize by the end of it, if not completely unrecognizable. And if that's the case, I just want to, no pun intended, then I just want to have something somewhere in the build log, right? Like, yeah. Or when you're showing it off, like, you know, case define R5, something that, you know, kind of throws my name back in it so that people recognize where it started. Because, like, the Define series have been very popular for case monitors because they're such a blank slate, right? I mean, there's, like, you know, some people say they're boring, they're just a square box, but sometimes that's what modders love. You know, it's like the front door panel's flat. You know, you have plenty of canvas there to either do cutting work on or painting. You know, the back side is flat and blah, blah, blah. So, yeah, like I said, the biggest thing is ask. Just ask us. If it's not something that interests me, I'll tell you it doesn't interest me or that I'm not able to support it at that time. But yeah, I mean, again, you might get rejected, but that's going to happen. I get rejected a lot. A lot.
And that's just by his wife.
That's by my wife. I was just thinking.
All right, let's see. What else? Okay. Say you're a new reviewer. I'm just going to read these comments exactly as they go. You get in a product, and you wind up citing lots of negatives on a product. If there are valid issues with the product, how does that impact send the individual future of the product? So someone reviews, for instance, someone reviews a new case. Like, let's say the Define R5, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone reviewed it, and they gave it just bad reviews because it's something's wrong with it. Something catastrophic.
Yeah.
How does that affect you when people ask you if you want, people want to take that and like get that as a sample for reviews, and how does it change your mind about, does that change your mind about the people that reviewed it, I should say?
Okay, so that's the thing. Whenever I send a case out or a power supply or whatever, I'm kind of putting it in uncharted territory, right? I don't know if you're going to like it or dislike it. And for the most part, I don't see the review till everybody else does. I see it when it goes live, right? I don't get this whole, like, let me look this over and make sure this is all flowery and rosy for me. So my personal stance on that is if your complaints are validated, if they're valid, then put them in there. I mean, if you think something sucks, say something sucks. I'm not looking for you to kiss my butt in the review. If you don't like something, tell me. You know, and tell your audience. That's how you maintain credibility with them. Now, if you're going off on a tangent with personal, you know, things that are more subjective than objective, then that's where there's a problem. If it's like, oh, I hate that case because it's black. It's like, okay, you kind of have to approach things with like
90% of the cases on the market.
Well, and that's the thing. That's where you kind of, you want to approach things with an objective mindset. Like, if you don't like it, stop and think if that was done for a reason. Right? Like, oh, how come they have, okay, for example, people are like, how come you have, you know, two USB 2.0 ports and two USB 3.0 ports? Why don't you have all four of them be USB 3.0 ports?
That's an easy question, though.
Okay, but to some people, to other people, it's like, you know, they've got a new, you know, freaking X99 build and blah, blah, blah. It's like, yeah, and there's some other guy who's upgrading with, you know, a freaking five-year-old motherboard that doesn't even have USB 3.0 support. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to make our case backwards compatible.
Yep.
And, you know, that's where we're trying to, sorry, I'm getting blasted here, but that's where we're trying to address as many options as possible. And a lot of times if you just ask, you might find out this was done for a very intentional reason that you might not have thought of. So what I would say, be true to yourself. If you generally don't like it, mention it. Just try to be objective though. If it's something that somebody else might like perfect example, oh, I hate it because there's no 5 1/4 bay. We have just as many people saying they love it because it has no 5 1/4 bay. So you might look at something like that, like, oh, it's got 3 5 1/4 bays. I personally don't use them. I think it would have been cool if they would have been removable or something like that. That way we could address both sides of the coin or something to that effect. The other thing is, if you don't understand something during the course of the review, feel free to reach out to the person that sent it to you, like, hey, I had a question on this. Why did you guys do this? Mm-hmm. You know, and find out. And it just makes you look more credible than somebody who, oh, this thing is crap. And then after the review goes public, the vendor comes back and says, actually, you were wrong. It was supposed to be this, and you published it wrong. Then you look like an idiot. So if you completely blast somebody in a review, I can't imagine.
At least have a good reason as to why.
Yeah. Yeah, make sure your position is defensible.
If the 5 1/4 bay falls down the second you open the side panel, that's understandable.
Yeah, exactly. So, and that's the thing, right? It's just, you know, make sure that there's some common sense in what you're saying. And most people are going to be pretty cool. They're going to stand there stuff that you don't like. And as long as it's not just like a hate fest based on personal opinion and not, you know, objective points, you know, you'll live to review another day. You know, everybody's put out a product that has not done as well as their flagship product, and you deal with it and you move on.
Mm-hmm. That you do. Let's see. What other questions? If you guys have questions, don't be afraid to ask.
I see Paul's Hardware has a question in here. How excited are you about Arctic Panther, my epic Define R5 build that I have a tempered glass side panel for? As long as he doesn't screw up the tempered glass side panel, drop it and break it, I'm looking forward to it.
Are they going to be like, as long as it doesn't suck, it's okay?
As long as it doesn't suck, like Kyle's hair. Oh, Kyle's in here, too.
Awkward. All right. So what else do we have on the outline? What else? Where are we at right now?
We're somewhere. And obviously, guys, if we didn't answer your questions, sling them in again.
Exactly.
Exactly. That's my
catchphrase. We've decided.
So one of the things that I can say is once you make contact with the person, if you're, you know, in the email process, if they ask for a time frame, stick to it. One of the things that I always do is I ask someone, what's your average turnaround time? And basically what that means is from when you get it to when it's published and uploaded or printed or whatever, what's that average time? Because I want to have a mindset for, if I give this to you, is it going to be 2 weeks? Is it going to be a month? Is it going to be 3 months? You know, and be upfront. Don't overcommit yourself ahead of time thinking, oh, I'm really going to make them happy. I'm going to get this review done in 3 days. You're just setting yourself up for failure. Because if you don't get it done in 3 days, now you're late on my calendar because you're the one that gave me that date. Mm-hmm. Now you're breaking your own deadline. I would much rather say it's going to be up in 2 weeks and then it's up in a week. As far as probably the follow-on question I'll get from people, what's an acceptable time period? That's going to vary from person to person. And it depends on what you're doing. I would say what I generally expect is 2 to 4 weeks from when you receive it. Anything beyond that, you know, again, if it's pre-approved, then it's fine, right? If it's a bunch of guys like, hey, I'm doing this, it'll probably take me 2 months to get to it. Okay, fine. Just set that expectation level and maintain it. If something goes wrong, communicate that. Hey, I was working on this and my car broke down. I don't have time to get it done. It's going to be delayed. Or the parts didn't come in or whatever. Just communicate that to the person that you're dealing with so they know and they can update their internal files. Like whenever I have reviews going, I always have a notes column next to it. It's like reviewers ill, you know, expected delay a week, 2 weeks, something like that. So if you think you're going to go beyond the time that you said it was going to be, I mean, you don't have to check in every day, but it's like, if it's going to go beyond the time that you originally allocated, just a quick note saying, hey, sorry, this is taking a little bit longer. I should have it up by this time.
Yeah.
And that goes a long way to getting you another review sample. Because I said before, most people can probably get one review sample from me. Because if nothing else, that's a test. I'm going to see how you do with it. And if the review you produce is junk, or if it takes you 4 months to do it when you told me it would take you 2 weeks, or it comes out, you know, factually incorrect, all those are going to weigh against you. I'm probably never going to send you anything again. Mm-hmm. But, you know, if you kick ass, then I'm more than happy to send you additional stuff. So
it's better. It's better to say something than to just be like, it's okay. He'll
understand. Don't hide. Don't duck like I'm a bill collector. Because a lot of times I'm not going to contact you. Like, you know, you tell me it's going to be 2 weeks. Like on the 15th day, I'm going to be like, hey, where the hell's that review? Mm-hmm. It's like, I'm going to go through my monthly report. I'm going to see, okay, it's been that long. You'll probably get a follow-up message. Hey, how's the review coming along? What's going on? You know, it's like you want to be the one to initiate contact and say, hey, look, this is running longer than I expected it to. Sorry.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I saw a question I don't think you will be able to ask. I mean, answer, I should say.
Try it. I'll tell you if I can't answer.
It's about when are you, will you ever come out with an Arc XL with a full side window?
An Arc XL with a full side window?
Yeah.
Like full side? Because it currently has a window.
Like I think he's talking about like of just like 90% window, 10%.
Okay, so panel. Like a bigger window?
Yeah, basically.
Probably won't.
Yeah.
You know, exactly. If there's gonna be a revision of the case. You know, at this point in the case's lifespan, it is what it is. So we probably wouldn't change that. That may be something in a revision, and that's where anybody that's seen me in a stream before. You know, my big thing is, you know, we're the company that listens. If you go to that contact page, one of the drop-down options is product suggestions. And believe it or not, when I talk about the system routing it to people, those actually go directly to our product developers. Mm-hmm. So if you want to see something, this whole business is about supply and demand. If we get 1,000 people saying, I want this thing, and yeah, obviously we will fact check that. But it's like, if we get a large demand for something, that's where these products come from, because we want to answer that demand.
Like fans?
Like fans. like overnight, like I can just...
That was hysterical. I'm just gonna tell you guys a quick story. So me and Josh were playing Sniper Elite. We're in TeamSpeak, right? And I don't even know how we got on the subject of case fans.
Cell brought it up.
Cell processing brought it up. And it just started talking about case fans, and Josh all nonchalantly is like, so would you guys like it if we made, like, if we came out with, like, fans, like, pressure-optimized and, like, high airflow fans?
No, it's even better because Cell goes, he's like, are you guys going to do any pressure-optimized fans? I'm like, why, would you like that?
Yeah, and then we're like, oh, yeah, of course we would. Literally the next morning, you get a tweet from Josh, and he's like, what did you say again?
I can work magic or something.
I did things or whatever, and it was about the fans. I'm just like, oh, wow, that was very... That like that was funny as hell.
Yeah, because I'm magic like that. So most of that with products that come out, like I said, let us know. I mean, that's what we push on our Facebook page and everywhere. It's like, tell our product developers what you want to see, and then that's kind of how you get it. You know, if you go to a restaurant and you waiter asks what you want to eat and you don't tell them, mm-hmm. you're not going to get what you want. Let's see. Looks like Dr. Patrick Bateman says, if you were to send a case to someone, is it an absolute necessity to build a computer in it? I know it makes a good case, how to highlight the features, so on and so forth. So, again, it depends on your channel or your page. If you don't normally do that, then no. If you've done it for the past 7 cases and you skip it on this one, you're probably going to get more flack from your viewers or your readers than you are from me from deviating from what you're doing. Some people may call that more of an overview than a review. But again, it's all how you package it and what your normal flow is. So, you know, obviously Lou from Unboxed Therapy for the longest time, he's unboxed it. That's what he did. He wasn't reviewing it. He wasn't saying this is better than this or better than that. It was unboxing. So, again, how it fits your channel or your page or what you're doing. So, I mean, I guess just communicate that. Just say, like, hey, I generally tend just to do, you know, open the box and kind of go through it, and I know it's good for a case. I can tell you there's probably going to be an expectation that you're going to get it done a lot quicker then, but mm-hmm. again.
Let's see. I saw another question. Okay, where was it? Okay, what is your biggest pet peeve that you hate? Well, it's the same thing. When people ask you for a review product. I think you kind of mentioned it before, but
yeah, it kind of depends, right? I mean, sometimes it just be the attitude of the email.
Like what's something that Kyle or Paul could do to just really annoy you in an email?
Send me an email. Just anything. No, it's for the most part, there's some that have like a level of expectation. I've met guys at CES that run small websites that think they're like God's gift to the tech industry and like want you to kiss their butt because they run a website and they're media. Mm-hmm. And then I've met people that like, you know, the editor in chief for Tom's Hardware, who is chill as hell.
Yeah.
You know, you wouldn't even know that, you know, he's running one of the largest tech sites, you know. And that's kind of thing. So that can kind of be off-putting, just like normal stuff. Other than that, I guess what would irritate me would probably be more of a...
Depend on your mood that day, probably.
Yeah, it depends on my mood. But it's someone who looks unprepared or obviously the marketing blank letter, yeah. Right? The non-committal, doesn't mention any of our products or anything about our company, and I can tell he sent it to 10 other people. Those ones I usually don't even reply to because it's like, you fired this off to 15 people. You probably even forgot you sent me one, so you're not going to miss it if I don't reply.
Okay.
I'll hop in here with one quick. Looks like Death Touch MK has asked this a couple times. Can you talk about what is the name of the Josh for Europe, the guy with your position in Europe?
Oh, that's a good question.
The first thing is that there is no Josh. I am the Josh of Europe. I'm the Josh of the world.
He is the Josh of the company.
Yes, yes. That's the other thing. I can't give out actual like email addresses. And it's going to depend because Europe's obviously a large area. We handle Eastern and Central Europe. Those are broken into different regions. So legitimately, the best thing I can tell you is if you're dealing with Russia, that's someone. If you're dealing with Deutschland, Europe. Austria, Czechoslovakia, that's someone else. If you're dealing with France, that's someone else. So use our contact page and make sure to put what country you're from. And that will get routed to the person that handles that specific region.
So Mystery X asks again, and this kind of fits into the question they've just got asked right now. Just wondering if you think region makes a difference in reviewers. He lives in Atlanta, Canada, nothing east of Ontario. Has any real tech influence on the net?
Region for me, when I handle more of like continent level stuff, is probably not going to be such a big thing. Like, you know, I don't care if I'm sending, because same thing in the US, right? Like I send stuff to Paul and Kyle, who are in California. I send stuff to Linus, who's north of California in Vancouver in Canada. I send people stuff like you, Greek, on the East Coast.
Yeah.
So for that, it's not, because I mean, with the internet now, stuff is so much more global. Maybe if you have a specific reach in your region or something like that, or maybe if the local tech shops look to you for advice or they follow you or something like that, that might be an angle that you could try. Like say, hey, I deal with a lot of the local, you know, computer shops in my region. A lot of them follow me, so my word carries a lot of weight with them if they're looking to stock new product. You know, push that side of it. Me personally, though, like specific region inside a country, the countries that I handle isn't as important.
Mm-hmm. Let's see. I know that Torn wanted me to ask you something, but go with what you were going to say.
No, I just said, Paul, I'm apropos, wants my things.
Yeah, I saw that.
Get in line, buddy. Get in line.
So does everybody else in this chat right now.
Yeah.
All right, so Torn wanted me to say, he says, this is for Josh. He said, love the Arc MIDI R2 we got in the original AMD test drive program along with the Tesla R2 650-watt power supply. Mm-hmm. Did you get the exposure you guys had hoped from that program? So it leads into the question, does a large product supply program still work in today's market, or does individual supply work out better in the long run?
So for me, I try to diversify. I want to do both. I want to send stuff to, you know, like Tom's Hardware, and I want to send stuff to a small niche guy, right? Because no one area covers everybody. Did I get the exposure that I was hoping for out of the AMD thing? Excuse me. Yes and no. You know, for
it's
me, there's
kind of quantify that.
Yeah, it's kind of an unknown, right? Like, same thing for me. Like, I'm dealing with a very large program, and I can tell you we spent a lot of money on that. You know, so on one side, you're kind of like, oh my God, yeah, this would be huge. Boom, it's going to be everywhere. And then the other side, it's like, okay, but I think what we got was good because it was a different tactic. It wasn't like we're buying, you know, ads at the Super Bowl to hit everybody at once. We're trying to kind of seed the population with a lot of tech enthusiasts that have a lot of influence inside their own circles. So, mixed bag. Not as grandiose as I thought it would be at first, but I was still happy with it.
All right, so let's see. Another question. So, is asking... what's up?
I saw one from Giving TNT. What if I have a question about, let's say, the R5 I'm reviewing? Do I just ask you directly, assuming we got in contact for the sample, or do I go through tech support? Talk to the person you initiated contact with, especially because they might be able to explain more of the features behind it, the design philosophy. Now, for example, if I sent you something and it was broken, either UPS beat the crap out of it, you snapped something off, or it showed up defective, I'd probably transfer you over to our tech support guys anyway. If you want, though, I mean, if it's one of those things where you want to do like expose style, let's see how good their tech support is, you could go for that. I mean, I stand behind my tech guys 100%. So if you had an issue and you wanted to be like, hey, part of my review was I checked out their tech support team. What was the response time? Did they get me new products? Yeah, then, I mean, that's up to you. Generally, though, your point of contact is your point of contact. You can funnel everything through there because they can generally get the questions answered for you in a way that you need it done. If it's a broken thing, that'd be tech. But if it's anything else, go through your contact.
Someone asked before, I don't remember exactly where the question was, but someone asked, what is easier to send, like cases and power supplies or fans and stuff like that? Like, what do you prefer sending?
For me, it's more about what I'm focused on at that point in time. Like right now, you know, if we could sell the Kelvin units, which I have one up there because that's just how I roll, in North America.
I think you have connects.
I think I know a guy. He's a dick, though. We could sell those in North America, I would be focusing largely on that because that's our new product at this time period. You'll see like our Edison Integra power supplies, we'll start shipping those out for review soon. So generally what's going to happen is the person's going to have key SKUs that they're focusing on for that quarter, that time frame or whatever, and that's going to be more what they're focused on. Does not mean that you cannot get the other stuff, but that's probably going to be what their focus is. Mm-hmm. For me, cost is cost. So it's like a power supply is going to be smaller and cheaper to ship. But the power supply itself is going to cost more than the case does. So it's kind of a 6 1/2 dozen.
Yeah, because it's heavier too.
Yeah, fans. Fans, I don't mind shipping fans out. I mean, again, the cost of it's not so much the issue. Sometimes it's something as much as the effort, right? Like I have to go through the same amount of effort to have a fan shipped out as I do to have a case shipped out. The same amount of contacts, tracking, logistics, internal reporting, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. So with fans, I mean, if your readers or your viewers want to see stuff on fans, then, you know, present that case to me like, hey, I've checked out Noctua's blah, 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 and Corsair's these and that, and, you know, I want to see how yours stack up. Okay, that makes more sense than, you know, I just want a fan. I can do a review on a fan really good and, you know, like that. Like, kind of like, I guess I don't want to be derogatory, but like, if you think that's your foot in the door of the company, it's not. Yeah. Because the other problem with the fans, there's only so much you can talk about. It's not going to be a very in-depth review, right? Mm-hmm. So
unless you're Jay.
Off, yeah, unless you're Jay.
Jay can do a fan review like I've never seen before, I swear to God.
But that's just it. A lot of people starting out aren't going to be able to do that or aren't going to have that mindset. So it's all about making the content interesting.
Yeah. Let's see. There was another question from unnamed gamer. He asks, I think he asked this before, but I'm not sure. Is asking for whatever product they can send you a bad thing? I know I don't want to come out too strong and ask for a Define R5, but I also don't want to undersell myself in asking for a case fan.
Yeah, so that's kind of like, you know, with the last one. For me, it's like, if you come at me like, hey, I want this brand new thing that you got out, okay. No offense, so do a lot of other people right now. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm not trying to be a dick, but why do I give it to you as opposed to this guy? Because I only have so many. Mm-hmm. You know, as I'm sitting in front of a wall, boxes, cases,
systems, and
yeah. But the thing is, legitimately, when it first comes out, you only have so many. If you make your case for what you want, again, pun intended, I guess. that's going to carry the most weight for you. Like, I would like to review this case because, and I think I'm apropos was was kind of echoing that earlier, that I said, if I know you want to review this product for this reason, that's going to carry more weight than I want to review something that you guys have. Send me whatever you have. I'll review it. Because
send them a little box of accessories. Be like, go for it.
Yeah, exactly. Let me find a screw around here somewhere and hold that up. But yeah, I mean, so yeah, like you said, you don't want to sell yourself short, but you also don't want to come in like, I want the moon and stars and everything else around it. So yeah, I mean, ask for what makes sense. One of the things I was going to talk about earlier that is also beneficial is in your initial contact, ask to be put on the press list. And what that is you'll go on like our press mailing list, where when we send out press releases about new products, you'll be one of the first to get it because that goes out to our media, right? And with that, you know, if you have a news section, if you have a print site or something like that, you know, talk about new products that come out. It doesn't have to be ours. It doesn't have to be everything we send out. But if you can also show that on your site or on your channel of, hey, you know, last time you guys launched this fan or this case, it was part of my weekly show when we did a little 5-minute back and forth about it, or I talked about it on my podcast, or I published your press release, because then you're showcasing that you've already given, you know, some level of visibility. And it's like, oh, okay, they're paying attention to our products. I think this guy probably has more background on it. I don't feel as concerned about sending him something. That's something that can really help you out. And that way you can also stay up to, you know, you can stay up to speed on what's coming out. You know, something new just came out, so you know, you can get in there and like, hey, you might not have any right now, but can I get on the list to review one of these? Mm-hmm. You know, there you go.
Let's see. Okay, Code 10 asked, would you have any suggestion for someone trying to get into the, into the community management for tech/hardware?
Trying to get
into your job, basically. How would someone that wants to get...
It's but a small part of my job is the problem, which is why you guys see me online at 10 p.m. at night. I wear many different hats.
And they all say douche on it.
Yeah. Obviously, what you want to have is a strong command of community already. It comes back to portfolio. Again, if you've been active in your community, like, you know, you got Paul A-bombing people all over the place looking like a terrorist. But,
shit.
You know, he's a community builder. Unless he's an H1Z1, then he'll just kill everybody, like, indiscriminately, like, unintentionally.
That's so funny.
But other than that, just show what you've done in that regard. Like, so for Code 10, like, you know, I stream every night, regardless if it's 5 people or 500. And, you know, I interact strongly with the people there. You know, get your people to rep for you. You know, it's like if you're looking to get a job, you know, don't be afraid to put down, like, community contacts as a reference. Or other social media influences is helpful as well. It's like, if there's somebody that you follow that has a large following and you can cite them, like, in, you know, like, yeah, this guy's pretty active in the community, does really good at what he does, that sort of thing. As far as like directly in there, it all depends on the company. Some companies have whole community management departments. Some have one person. In some companies, that's somebody high ranking. In some companies, that's like, it's like an intern job.
Yeah.
You know, like, a key example is like, so for example, if you're tweeting at Hertz or something like that, and this is just one segment of the community, right? Mm-hmm. Whenever you get a reply back from a large corporation and it has like -JH or something at the end, that's how you can tell it's a team of people, because that's the initials of the person on that team that replied to you. Mm-hmm. So it'd be like, we're really glad you liked your car, Mr. Smith, -JH. So, you know, it's like John Hupton or whatever is the guy that replied to. So I don't know if that's helpful or not, Code, but I'm trying.
Okay, Gary asked this question, and I think we can all answer this one really easily. He said, we talked about this the other night, but do you think it's smart for someone to try and get to YouTube to make money, or should it be a hobby first? I'll answer it. Like Josh said it before, if you're doing it for money, don't bother, because you won't be making money for a long, long, long time. If you're going to do it because you enjoy it. And if you get free stuff out of it, awesome. But do it because you enjoy it. Don't do it because you're looking for a paycheck.
Yeah, it's you know, the whole chase money and sadness will follow, mm-hmm. chase happiness and money might follow, that type of thing. So it's, exactly. Again, just set your sights realistically. 50-50 shot. Don't do it for the money.
Sal asks a good question. How do you decide what is a conflict of interest when doing an event like this as yourself? I'm going through some of those questions myself as I make my own content.
For me, it's not so much a conflict of interest in the sense that I don't, okay, so let me back that up. Generally, unless I'm like babbling marketing speak, I always like to say that what I'm saying is me and not Fractal, right? Because they can't control what I say right now. If I offend somebody, they didn't tell me to do that. And what irritates me is that people so quickly want to associate a person with a company's mentality, right? And it's like, okay, if you had a rude flight attendant on American Airlines, it doesn't mean that American Airlines hates you, right? It, mm-hmm. it means that that person was having a bad day, made a bad choice, whatever. So with me, it's more of a, to protect the company, if I say something stupid, this is me talking right now. This is not something they told me to say. Now, I know they will back me on this. I know that there's no, like, I have to separate and Josh, don't work for us. I mean, if that was the case, you wouldn't see Fractal boxes behind me.
Yeah.
But at the same point in time, I'm not speaking for the company. I'm speaking for myself because it's also my experiences that I'm pulling off of and my time in the industry. So I guess that's where I kind of try to divide it.
Someone else asked before. They asked, do you throw all your cases out of sports cars?
Yeah, when I can. The damn door on the 911 was too small, so I couldn't hit Kyle with it. I tried so hard. He had his little lazy George Michael hairdo going on, and
I was going to try and George Michael hairdo.
That's how he rolls.
Oh, God, I like that. Let's see where we are right now. Oh, God. If you guys have any more questions, don't forget to put them in the chat. Oh, okay. Are you like?
And I hope you guys are enjoying this. If I'm droning on and you want to be done, just let us know, or just
drop Leah, let us know. I'll close the call and kick Josh out.
Just boot me out. Still talk to myself for 10 minutes, and then I figured that I would.
And you don't realize the call's over.
Hey, where did everybody go?
Let's see. Are you likely to send a power supplier fans with a case for review to also advertise your other products, or do you generally care if the other competing brands are also showing off in video showcasing your products? So basically, when you send a Fractal case to someone, do you want to send a Fractal PSU to go along with it to add more like a cherry on top of the cake, or do you care if they put like a Corsair case or something else in there?
Okay, so yeah, perfect world, it's all my products, right?
Of course. Fit.
Yeah, am I going to send a power supply along just so it's in the photo op for your build? No, because it's all a cost thing, right? I mean, it's all of a sudden that's a $100 prop for a photo shoot. Plus, again, I mean, I understand that some people want a Corsair power supply because they already have one, maybe. I mean, you know, I don't think many people anymore do like, I'm going to do a ground up build. It's that gradual, I'm going to swap this component out, that component out, this new graphics card, and so on. And I think a lot of people probably upgrade their case when they upgrade a motherboard because you're ripping everything else out anyway. But
yeah.
I digress. Mm-hmm. If you ask for it, it's possible to get it. If you have, like, if you wanted to review both, then yeah, by all means. You know, it's like if you're going to review the power supply, I wouldn't have a problem sending that. Mm-hmm. The fan thing, though, I don't have a problem with that. The only thing is, if you're doing like temperature testing, I want it to be indicative of what the case was like stock, and that's probably what your readers or viewers want. Mm-hmm. So they don't necessarily want it with. And they sent me 4 extra fans, and it's like super loud now, or it blows air out the back, and it's super cold. It's like, well, yeah, but when you buy it, it's got 2 fans in it. So, but yeah, I'm not adverse to that, but it doesn't automatically come with that to preclude other people's hardware. Mm-hmm. You know.
All right. Let's see. Giving TNT says about the question he asked earlier. The fact I'm French relates to mostly me being in Northern America. What would you do about French videos?
So, like, if you're talking about, like, I assume like French Canadian French.
Yeah, he's in Canada.
Okay, so yeah, so if you're hitting that market, honestly, again, I'd have nothing against it. If you're in North America, then yeah, it'll get sent to me. I would probably be open to that. The big thing is, right now, we don't actively sell in that area because there are certain restrictions as far as packaging goes. Like, your packages have to be half English, half, like, at least 50% French. So for us, that requires a whole other run through a production line, new boxes created, stuff like that. That all comes with developing markets. But Okay, if I misunderstood earlier, I apologize. If it's regionally in my region, send it to me. I'd be happy to take a look at it. Obviously, I probably wouldn't know if you're ripping us. Actually, I would know if you're slagging us because I just get my French guy to translate it for me. So
he has a French guy.
Yeah, Vincent. Yeah. So by all means, like I said, just contact me, and that goes for anybody on here. You know, if you're seriously interested in reviewing stuff, go through our chain. I'll be happy to look it over. I'll tell you right now, I'm not going to be able to approve everybody. Some of you are going to get rejected. Some of you are not. Mm-hmm. But, hey, I'm willing to look at it, right? I'm totally down with giving people a chance if I see a value there. So,
yeah. And there's no harm in asking, really. If you're worried, just ask. Because just like anything else, the most anyone can say is no. You know, they're not going to send you an email of them pointing a picture and laughing at you for asking. It's not going to happen, so...
Maybe if you're apropos, I might do that.
Probably. God. Oh, God. All right. Let's see. I had a question that I saw. Here. Brian has a question. Sergeant Ballistic has a question. Has a recent upload... Oh, I'm sorry. Has a recent uproar... This is a good question. I'm surprised we didn't get this earlier. Has a recent uproar about product integrations and sponsorships on YouTube... and their terms of service affected how you work with big and small YouTubers? That's a good question.
Yeah, most definitely. Probably not so much for the reasons that you would think. So there's when you delve through the YouTube speak of what's going on, basically what they're getting at, what they're trying to pull out of that is this video brought to you by Fractal Design logo, blah, blah, blah. That's what they want to get rid of. Or at least they want you to no longer be able to do, they want to do it themselves. And that's exactly why they don't want you to do it. It's because they want to sell that. So there's obvious workarounds, right? Mm. Like, okay, someone comes in wearing a t-shirt with the Fractal Design logo on it, and you know, you can do that. But does it affect me? Yeah, because there are people I already had signed contracts with where we're going to do these standard, you know, the pre-rolls or ad integrations. And then now we're kind of having to look at that, and it's like, okay, do you want to, you know, do you want to thumb your nose at YouTube and do it anyway? Or are we going to go back and redo this? You know, how do you want to approach it? And then there's other people where it didn't matter. Like Linus, it didn't really matter because with those were integrations where it's like they were different each time. So it wasn't like a cut pre-roll. They were usually at the end of the video, so they were post-rolls. But yeah, it makes it a little bit more difficult because in theory, if you're playing by the rules now, you're going to be doing different integrations each time. It's not going to be a set thing. My logo is not going to be as prominent. But most of you that have seen my advertising know I'm not really much of a logo freak. I'm more trying to get like an experience across, something that's memorable.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Because logos are, they're whatever. You can get a logo from anything.
Well, and yeah, at the end of the day, I'm not Coke or Pepsi. You're not going to walk down the street, that looks like the Fractal logo. Yeah, because it says Fractal right there. It's, you know, exactly. It's just one of them. Yeah, so I don't know.
Let's see. Okay. Okay, here's a good one. If someone asks for a review product and gets turned down, do you encourage them to contact them again in the future when they get a larger following or fix whatever the issue was?
Yeah, good question. Both. I mean, you know, obviously if you keep growing, by all means, go back. I mean, very seldom is someone going to come back, I'm not sending you stuff because you're small. You have to get to X number and then you can contact me again.
Yeah,
you know, it's more or less like, you know, I don't have allocation right now. I don't have whatever. So, you know, for all intents and purposes, just hit them up again. I mean, give it some time. You know, if it was because you're small and you had 100, you know, followers, don't hit them when you have 200. I mean, yes, that's 100% increase. People aren't going to really take that seriously, though. You know, approach them again when you think it's right. If you know why you got rejected, because I think a lot of people when they go into it, they have an idea of why they think they might get rejected. I'm too small, my stuff doesn't look professional enough, or whatever. Mm-hmm. So fix what you think is the problem, and then, yeah, definitely approach them again.
Unless you're Cooler Master Torn to be says.
Oh.
Shots fired.
Oh, I'll have to tell Rajiv about that.
Oh, God. All right.
looks like Dr. Patrick Bateman had another one. If someone were to purchase a lot of products from Fractal and review them before contacting you, would you be less likely to send review samples out of expectations that we're going to still continue buying? I'll be honest with you, I probably don't think that deep about it. You know, if you come to me and say, hey, look, I reviewed 5 Fractal products, me personally, I'd probably be more inclined to be like, okay. But it's still going to come into, if you've bought 50 Fractal products and you have a total combined view of 47 and a half views somehow, you know, that's going to weigh in on it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, if you're showing dedication, I'm much more apt to send you something. Plus, if nothing else, it shows that you have product familiarity with it. You know, you played with 5 other products, so you kind of know what to expect. You know how they're made. So.
Exactly. Yeah. Let's see. There was one. Okay. Killer Clown J is like, how long before we send you emails after the show?
Well, let's see. What's Greek's? My email is 1, 2, 3.
He added me, but I know it's for you.
Yeah. So what I would say is, okay, the general thing is basically wait. You know, it's like, again, if I get 50 emails after the show, I'm going
to
have...
It's going to take you a while to go through them.
It's going to take me a while to go through them. And then if you're the random guy that pops up next week, you're going to get more attention than the guy that shows up now. Again, have your approach thought out. I mean, it's good that, you know, if you're listening to my suggestions, but if it's just cookie cutter with no personality as far as like, you know, don't rush it. If you already know how you want to approach me by all means. Just go through the process. It'll get to me. Just make sure that you have those key components in there of, you know, what you want, what you're going to do, what your benefit is. Another thing, don't do the self-deprecating thing. Don't do the, I know I'm small and you probably won't send me something. It's like, okay, I'm not going to take a pity story. I'm not trying to be a jerk, but it's like, if you're kind of already going into the situation with that attitude, it's like either A, you're not going to guilt me into it, or B, I'm not going to do it because of pity or anything like that. It's like it's purely a business decision. I have to look and see, am I going to get out of this what I put into it? Mm-hmm. So,
another good question was by Code 10. Hold on. I'm waiting for the stream to not buffer because I don't know what's going on tonight with this stupid ass internet. All right. Code 10 asks, he's like, how close are you with your competitors in the industry? Is it more cutthroat market or question mark?
Pretty close. I mean, it's not like we're inside each other's development rooms and I don't know what they're making before they make it. But if I'm at CES or something like that, I'll hang out with Shannon from Thermal Take or Rajiv from Cooler Master. You know, I know a lot of the guys. So yeah, I mean, it's we're all doing the same thing. And honestly, I don't see Cooler Masters as competition because I think we hit different ends of the spectrum, right? We're more of the minimalistic. They're more of like the
flashy.
Yeah. So, like I said, I mean, we're pretty chill with each other. A lot of times it just comes down to personality. I've known guys and competitors that were jerks, and I don't want to talk to them because they're a jerk, not because they're a competitor. Mm-hmm. So.
Not bad. Was there another one? They get rejected. Sorry.
Paul or Lemon Pound Cake, as he prefers to be called. Let's see here. What types of sponsorships does Fractal Design offer for YouTube channels or Twitch streamers? So, for me, again, I'm not a very cut and dried type of person. I'm more of a situational awareness type of guy. So I want to do something that fits. I don't actually have like packages like, oh, you've got this many followers, you get bleh. And you can ask any of the guys that I advertise with. I benchmark them all, even if it's Linus. I look at the numbers and see how he's performing, and I decide if I want to advertise with Linus again. Mm-hmm. So it's all about performance. I think that's your mom calling me, Greek. It's all about performance.
The infamous phone call.
But the other thing to look at, too, is, like I said, I try to be tactical. So I will look and see maybe how big your channel is, what makes sense. For example, if I'm doing a pre-roll or something like that on YouTube, generally what's going to happen is if you're getting this many views, I'd probably be willing to pay this much for the ad. If you're getting this many views, I'd be willing to pay this much for the ad, that sort of thing. So those things kind of scale. It's not whether I will or won't do it. It would be on what level. Now, other things that come into play are obviously if it's a pre-roll, if I have to supply you with that, then that's another hurdle. But as you can see, I tend to try and reach out. So generally what I do on YouTube is I do pre-rolls, post-rolls, and integrations, where instead of paying YouTube the money, I prefer to work with the content creators and do it directly that way. Twitch, I'm still very much in the research process of Twitch, but I'm looking at some things. So,
yeah,
I'll put that where it is. I'll say some stuff is coming.
Shimkins, Josh, who's the best vendor to go drinking with after a show?
let's see here. Me?
Well, other than you.
I would
say George from Corsair because he's so big. He could probably put some away.
Like, if you're talking about capacity, I'm trying to think. There's some, I don't know if I want to name names, you know, because obviously what happens and all that. But yeah, I will say that I party pretty good with the guys from Cooler Master, the guys from Thermal Take. I know the EVGA guys well. So, yeah, there's a lot of good ones to party with.
Nice.
Again, it comes down to personality. So,
now, Kitty asked a question. I already know what you're going to say, but I'm going to ask it anyways because it's Kitty. Kitty wants to know if Fractal Design will eventually get into PC accessories as well, like keyboards, mouse, and etc.
So I will tell you right now, the plan is, from what I hear, no. But again, I cannot talk about products may or may
naturally,
not be.
Naturally, naturally.
There we go. I don't see it happening anytime soon. That is a very, very saturated market. And it's
because now everyone's coming out with something like that.
Yeah, and you have some pretty big boy players too. I mean, you've got Razer, Logitech, guys that have metric butt tons of cash, and to stand out there is very, very expensive. So I don't foresee it happening anytime soon. But again, product suggestions, you could suggest that. If we see a strong demand for it, we'd be willing to take a look at it.
Okay. Follow-up question. What size of channels do you sponsor? Are smaller channels open to discussion? 6 to 10K subs, for example.
I think
we
yeah, yeah. I mean, yeah, yeah. It's open. So, for example, I was sponsoring. I was the first one to do pre-rolls with Joanne Techlover, and she's at like 12K.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah. So, I definitely, granted, I knew Joanne, but... Yeah, I'm open to it. Obviously, if you do one review and then come back to me and say, hey, can I be sponsored or get an ad? odds are less likely, It's like, if you go start a new job and ask for a raise on the third day. I would say the entry into that is going to be through the review process and developing a relationship. Mm-hmm. Because the other thing a lot of people don't understand, and this is something I know Greek knows something about, is it is very difficult for me to pay somebody. Yes. To just give you money is difficult because what we basically have to do, if you do not have your own corporation, LLC, sole proprietorship, own EIN tax number, is I essentially have to hire you as a subcontractor of Fractal Design. I have to send you W-9s. You become a 1099 employee. I then have to, because the IRS kind of frowns on companies just sending cash off to random people on the internet. It's kind of a red flag. So, that's also part of it. If it's going to take me 3 days of paperwork and blah, blah, blah to even get, like, say, a $50 ad integration, it's like, it may sound like I'm lazy, but I might be like, no offense, it's just not worth the hassle.
Yeah.
So, hope that kind of shed some light on that there. Mm-hmm. Plus, then it becomes, at the end of the year, we don't want to have 47 different people we have to track, because then at the end of the year, we have to send out those earnings statements and deal with the Swedish Board of Trade in Chicago. They don't want to send out 178 of those things.
Because that sounds like fun.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, paperwork.
Nope. Okay, so if someone sends a request, do you reply if it's a rejection so that way they won't keep sending follow-ups?
So kind of a mixed answer there, right, is the fact that ideally you would follow up if your channel continues to grow. I think the only reason you shouldn't follow up is if, you crash and burn or you stop. Yeah, or if you're doing it too frequently. I make my best effort to reply to everybody if I can. There are some that slip through the cracks, and if I've done that, I apologize. You're more than welcome to send a follow-up email. I emailed you a few months back and never really heard back. Something like that. Because things do slip through the cracks. That's just the nature of the business. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I try to reply back and just. Yeah, I'll be up front and say, I'm sorry, I don't have allocation, or I'm not able to at this time,
So Jeremy Dwayne asks, Is it worth getting an LLC if you're just doing it as a hobby? That's a good question. If you're just doing YouTube as a hobby, is it worth getting an LLC?
I mean, that's going to be a personal question, right? I mean, it depends on how much you're going to put into your hobby. There might be, and I'm no financial wizard, there might be benefits from different tax write-offs that you could get at the end of the year from being an LLC, you know, for the gear that you buy for your hobby, so on and so forth. As far as just with the mentality of making money off of YouTube, I would say no. Because the only time that that's really going to come into play is if somebody pays you to advertise. Just receiving the products and stuff like that, as long as you're not being paid a service, that should be a non-issue. So,
Bad Apollo asks, does Fractal Design do product support instead of the monetary to bypass the W9 tax thing? I'm going to say yeah.
Well, yeah, I guess I hate to use the word with bypass and tax in the same sentence on a recorded podcast.
That's very
podcast.
Sketchy, yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't say, you know, that we want to... we're trying to dodge anything. You know, but I've said this before, that's why it's always easier for vendors to send you hardware, because there's a lot less approval product or process to it. I don't have to go get this signed, like, hey, I'm sending a check off to random Joe Blow, you know, here's his email address, 123@gmail.com. Like, can we have some more anonymity to this? But yeah, I mean, we'd be willing to do something like that, or if it's like, but the other thing is, like, I want the review or whatever to be genuine. I don't want it to be like, hey, I sent you 5 cases, now go put that review out there. You know, like, I bought you off. I don't want it to be that. But I'm pretty flexible looking at different options.
Nice, nice. This is Fart and Dust asks, which form factor interests you and which is showing the most innovation? Which case form factor, I would assume?
Mini ITX seems really popular right now because you can still do a lot with it. You know, I guess the small form factor market.
I would agree.
I legitimately do not have a whole lot of love for, like, the really thin client stuff that I think a lot of people do. Like, not just Steambox, but, like, for example, the Digital Storm does, like, their... I can't remember what it's called.
Like, oh, and like Alienware, like their X51 or whatever.
Yeah, and then like CyberPower has like the Bolt or something like that. Like the really thin ones. Falcon Northwest is the Tiki. From a case manufacturer standpoint, I don't like that as much because they have a BOM, right? A bill of materials. They have a configurator on their website. They're only going to let you pick stuff that fits in there. For us to do that, you know, we kind of send it out into the world, and then we get a guy that goes on YouTube and goes on Newegg, buys the case, and then gets pissed he can't fit like an R295X2. And like, why the card's longer than the damn case? Why would you think that could fit in there? But then for us, that becomes a tech support call, and a guy gets pissed and returns the case because he didn't read through it. So that sector becomes a little bit more difficult for me to swallow from our standpoint, because we kind of have to kick it out there and hope people understand you're going to need a riser card or a ribbon cable, you're going to need this, you're going to need that. So... But yeah, I'd say Mini ITX thing is cool. A lot of people are going that direction.
I like Mini ITX too. It's really interesting to see exactly, because it's like a challenge too. It's a challenge to see what you can fit in such a small form factor and get the most power you can out of it. That's what I like about it. So I would like to do an ITX build eventually, and because now you can ITX. Don't they have, I think they're coming out with an ITX like X99 board now or something like that, or it's a mini ATX or whatever. So can you just imagine an ITX build like that with an X99? That'd be stupid. So
thing is, like, they used to be like, you know, the mini ITX stuff like that, they were all weak performers. It was all like some slim client designed to do internet and email, and now it's like you can actually get powerful hardware in there. So let me see here. Do we have anything else on the outline? Post review. Here's a big thing. If you get through, you get the product, you produce it on time, email them when the review goes live. Do not assume that they have the time to check every single YouTube channel, website, web page every day to see when the review goes live. You don't have to, but it's kind of like, hey, if you did it, you might want to let them know, like, hey, review went live today. Here it is. Go check it out. Another added bonus is if you do awards of any kind and they got one, include like a JPEG or a PNG file in the email, because it saves them the trouble of having to go and ask you for it or try and download it off your site, you know, right click, save image as. B, it also greater likelihood that they're going to use your award logo on their website and in their marketing communication because it was so easy to use. Plus, hey, they got an award. Boom. Someone that's not going to read a full 5-page review or watch a full 10-minute case video, they're going to want to see the conclusion. And that award logo is a very quick conclusion. Hey, mm-hmm. editor's choice. So then for people like us, where we have a very limited amount of time to capture people's,
or a attention, damn good award.
Yeah, or a damn good award or something like that. Then that's something where, like, boom, I could slap this on a product box. I could slap this in a display ad. I could put it up on our website. And then that's going to get you more notoriety in return. Mm-hmm. So communicate it back to them.
Very nice. Okay, so Matthew Tomlinson just asked, when I'm contacting a company about a product review request, do I use their media email or customer support? I think you would go through media email, not customer
support. Yeah, and I'm assuming most people haven't been here for the whole call. Yeah, media. Customer support's just that. If you didn't buy something, you're not a customer. So
exactly.
Go through media, because media is also going to be the ones that are going to hand it out, or if not, they can get you to the right place, because in theory, that's what you are, right, is your media.
Mm-hmm. Reicher says that he just wants to thank... he thinks it's super cool to see you doing this, being active on Twitter, Twitch streams and everything, and showing love and answering everyone's question. Basically, thank you for doing what you're doing. So there you go. That's for that. That's for you right there.
Well, thank you.
C. Berry asks, what tax-related things are there when vendors send hardware, like what is the... Oh God. Punctuation is your friend, Barry. What is the cutoff when you have to pay taxes on items, and is it a high amount? Like, what tax-related stuff are
involved? I honestly don't know. I don't want to, malpractice and give out tax advice, because it's states and things like that. Best thing I can tell you is to double-check your local municipality or your state laws, stuff like that, because that can all come into play. From what I understand, and this is just what I understand, it's generally the value of the product itself, not how much product you got over the course of the year. And generally, having the product is not something that is going to incur taxes. It's if you turn around and sell it or something like that, right? Mm-hmm. Or if you try and claim something on your taxes, like, oh, I went and bought all this crap. Really? Okay. You're making $42,000 a year and you have $107,000 worth of tech hardware that you bought within the last 6 months. Mm-hmm. So, but again, I'm no tax expert, so I honestly couldn't tell you.
Yeah, exactly. That's for... that would be a question for your accountant, like Loving the Taco says. That's very true.
Or, H&R Block or something like that. Yeah, hit him up.
I like this question. This is a very interesting question.
Shimmickens?
Yep, exactly. You want to ask? Okay, I'll ask
you. You ever thought of sending a gag to some of the YouTubers? Oh, yeah.
That would be amazing.
Well, Linus... but he wouldn't wear it. He'd have, Luke wear it or something like that.
Not like that kind of a gag, like playing a prank on them. Like, for instance...
Oh, I thought you meant like just gagging. Like, I did a hot pepper. That was close enough.
That video was hysterical. For instance, let's say like you're going to give them like a new... Let's say you send them one of the Kelvins, right? When instead mm-hmm. of a Kelvin, it's like a Corsair H100i.
Yeah, you'd have to have, obviously, a pretty good working relationship with them, which I do. I know one guy, and this was on the sales side. I had no part in this.
Yeah.
He had received a demo sample prototype from one of our competitors to decide whether his company wanted to carry the product. And it was a pretty big company. And it was one of our pretty prominent competitors that came over from, the factory in Shenzhen or whatever. He opens it up, and there's, like, crumbled freaking Pringles all over inside the case. Like, whatever guy in the factory been working on it was like pounding down chips while he's packaging up the box. And this is supposed to be like, a prototype sample, very high end. So anyway, when we caught word of that, when we sent him ours, we sent him like three cans of Pringles unbroken inside the case.
I like that. I like that.
Oh, Pulse Hardware says Josh is in S&M confirmed. Wait, Paul's confirming that? I didn't think you were going to tell people, Paul.
He is.
Soul Patch Paul's down with it.
Don't let him fool you. He is. I know for a fact.
That's how he does it.
All right. So, what were you saying before we got off on that tangent?
Oh, what was I saying? I don't know.
You're talking about post review, about sending emails.
Yeah. So, send that follow up email, letting them know where it was published. Don't self-aggrandized to a great degree, but if something beneficial happened, like, hey, it's getting more views than any of my other videos I've gotten or more quickly, you know, call that stuff out. Again, you want to kind of try and make it easy for them, especially if you're starting out. You want to make it easy for them to pick you again, right? Mm-hmm. This guy was really responsive. He did a very good review that was factually correct, even if he didn't love everything about our product. He got it up in time. He provided links to it when it was done. He sent his pictures, blah, 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 blah. So, you know, those things all make you more likely to get picked again. But for the first few rounds, you're probably going to have to ask, because a lot of times, especially guys like me that are horrible at forgetting stuff, I might be dealing with like 40 different reviewers at any given point in time. And if a new product comes out and I didn't call you specifically to see if you wanted to review it, does not mean I won't give you one. You know, don't feel like you intentionally got past, like, hey, I did one product review with this. Because I'd had that feeling before. It's like, hey, I did a review with them last time, and they didn't even contact me about this one. It's like, okay, then contact them. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like they can't possibly remember everybody. So,
very true. I got a question. Mm-hmm. I don't know if we asked this before, but what do you prefer? Like, let's say you send someone a case. Do you prefer them doing just a straight up review of the case, or put like building inside the case? I know what I prefer to watch, mm-hmm. but I want to know what you prefer to watch. Not as the company. I'm talking about you personally.
Me personally, I guess I like to see a build. Well, okay, if the build is well done, I like to see the build in there. Yeah. No one wants to see something that's slapped together in 10 seconds to, you know, just test temps.
Yeah.
But I also know, like, from the review side of things, like, obviously it takes a lot longer to build in there. But I like seeing it fully populated. I mean, obviously, in my ideal ones, it's both. It goes like, you know, here's the empty case, then boom, fully populated. Because I think it gives people a better feeling for how much room a case has or how well they can wire it. So
I like that. I like that.
But it's not a requirement.
Ooh, is there a minimum age for working with you guys? If someone who is 13 comes to you and asks to work with you, are there legal/other reasons why you wouldn't work with them? Do you have an age limit, basically?
Well, the first thing you have to look at is whatever platform you're on. Does that have an age limit? Like, mm-hmm. you know, in theory, you cannot be on Facebook if you're under 13, right? So you couldn't be a 12-year-old posting reviews.
It's something on YouTube, too. I forgot what it is.
Yeah, so, I mean, that would be the first thing. And again, I'm not a lawyer, so you probably want to check your local jurisdictions. Mm-hmm. As far as working with you, if we're sending you product, I don't believe that there is necessarily a concern, like a legal issue with that. Like, we wouldn't be able to pay you because then you get into child labor, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, personally, I would stay away from it myself, unless everything was all ironed out. That's why a lot of times you see that, people will, like, when they were in contests, they have them for older age groups because no one wants you contacting their kid. Hey, you want something? Why the hell you call my 13-year-old kid?
Yeah, really. 18 or older.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And that's usually a scapegoat, like, just to get around most of the laws because, hey, then you're an adult. You can make those decisions yourself. Mm-hmm. What's your cell processing? That's what I like about Tasty PC. Yeah, so that's another example. Like, then you get people like Tasty PC that do these, like, wicked, sick, freaking liquid cooling builds in cases. I'm like, okay, yeah, like, okay, now you made my case look better because you got everything color coordinated and totally kicked out. So, yeah, personally, I like seeing stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. What was I just going to say just now?
Oh, thank you. I'm apropos. He says, minimum age requirement to own a Google account in the United States is 13 and older, so that might obviously still not play into what the legal age is for, you know, what is, and that's the other thing, what do they deem work? You know, if we're not giving you cash, but we're giving you something in return, I don't know. So I'd say that's on you.
I got a question again. Mm-hmm. How much stuff do you think in an average year, right? How much product do you think you give out to reviewers on average?
Let me see here. As long as you have a screen cap, I can bring up one of my reports and tell you.
Oh, that's convenient.
Yeah, what do you know? I track this stuff because I'm like that. I'm not sure.
It's kind of like, you know, your job.
It's kind of like someone has to pay for this junk. there's even separate reports on how much shipping we spent on stuff related to giveaways versus, you know, reviews versus projects.
Nice.
And then, you know, let's see here. So let me see what I got here. Let's see here. I can tell you my budget is for this year, or roughly. I won't tell you exactly.
Roughly, yeah.
This year I'll probably hit about $72,000 worth of
samples.
That's product cost. That's not necessarily shipping cost. Mm-hmm. So that'd be on top of that. But it all depends, because I have to factor that at the beginning of the year. I don't have the running total right now. But yeah, we ship out quite a lot of stuff.
Okay. Does Fractal Design give industry pricing to reviewers who aren't able to provide a product for them to review?
Honestly, there's no such thing really as industry pricing. I mean, unless you're talking about like what
it's Newegg pays. It's not like a car, so.
Yeah, unless you're talking like what Newegg pays to you know, like buy it from us, in which case there we have the problem of we cannot sell to individuals because we do not collect sales tax, so we can only sell to other businesses, mm-hmm. like B2B sales. So yeah, and then it'd honestly be very difficult to coordinate. You know, it had to be like if we did something like that, like okay, here's promo code 12345 that takes 25% off the cost at Newegg. It would entail us like working with Newegg to create a single use promo code that we then, you know, then you have to order from Newegg. So honestly, right now, no. It'd just be we'd be able to supply you with a product or not.
Not bad, not bad. So when you give a new product to someone, mm-hmm. obviously you have to send it to them earlier. And they're under NDA for until a certain amount of time.
Mm-hmm.
How early do you usually send out product to reviewers? Like with the Definer 5, when you sent it to Paul, Kyle, Jay, Dimitri, Logan, how early did you send it to them?
So generally, I like to give people as much time with the product as possible. With stuff that launches on a certain date, you're usually committed, right? You have a launch date of this at this time, and you try and get it to them as early as possible. But it's also one of those things like, hey, let's give the reviewer 6 months with it. Like, why the hell would we do that? We could be selling it, you know, 5 months earlier. My general rule of thumb is I want to give them no less than 2 weeks. You know, because especially if they're building the case, they need time to do it. You also want to have the mentality on my end that's like, hey, the earth doesn't stop because we're launching a new product. They're not going to drop because at any given point in time, I know Paul and Kyle and Eber and stuff,
they can tell you. See what Paul just put in chat?
What?
He's like, I had 4 hours.
No bullshit. 4 hours, whatever. Hey, man. My soul patch. Hey. No, he had 3.5, I think. But, you know, the reality is you want to give them as much time as possible so that they can do, like, a well-developed review. Like, a rushed review is crap. So 2 weeks at a minimum. I try to get more if I can.
Good to know. That's good.
The other thing is, the longer they have the product, the greater the likelihood there's going to be a leak. Not necessarily intentionally, but especially YouTubers, they forget it's sitting in the background of one of their shots of something else they're doing. You know, it's like, so you got to kind of hit that, you know, that that quick narrow margin there.
Has that ever happened?
I've seen stuff unintentionally leaked before.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what do you do when something like that happens?
There's not a whole lot you can do. I mean, you can blacklist the reviewer if you think it was intentional. A lot of times it's a screw up and it's just like, dumbass, why the hell did you do that? You know? For example, I'm not going to name the name, but like there was a leak recently. Someone basically, they did the review, they filmed it, they uploaded it, they left it as, you know, so to people that don't private. Know, obviously, we're yeah, scared. Private.
Yeah.
Yeah, so there's like three different settings for YouTube videos. There's basically there's private, there's unlisted, and then there's public. Private means basically only people with the account access can view it. Mm-hmm. Unlisted means you have to have the URL to that video to be able to view it. So it won't show up in search results, but if someone sends you that link, you can go view it. Then there's public, which everybody sees and sends out all the notifications. Mm-hmm. This person had left it as unlisted, which is fine, because unless he shared the video, no one would find it. But then added it to a playlist that was public, like case reviews. So anybody that went into the playlist then saw it there. So it was one of those things where, okay, intentional, not intentional, I don't know. I mean, if we're not going to get CSI out here and try and decide lie detector test if he did it to try to scoop everybody else or if it was just, you know, something that happened. But I can tell you if you're caught doing that and it's deemed as on purpose, like you're trying to scoop everybody, the vendor's going to be pissed. More than that, you're going to have the rest of the reviewers pissed because you just screwed them. Like, everybody's waiting to go live at midnight, and then you boosted it 6 hours early. You cut their scoop. You took all the views. You're going to piss off the rest of the people in your reviewer community by doing that.
Mm-hmm. You're going to screw yourself.
Yep.
Good Lord. All right. There was... okay. See, this is something that I've done. Do you think a build live on Twitch using one of your products is just as useful as a review on YouTube?
If it's filmed well. I mean, you know, that's the other thing, right? Like, if it's, you know, you've got one camera and half the time you're moving with your butt in front of it because you're trying to work on the computer and you forget about camera angles, and yeah, it's going to suck.
Yeah.
But no, I think it'd be cool. I think people would like to watch that. It'd be something kind of different. I think it'd just be a difficult thing to film live and show most of what you're doing as opposed to looking like somebody just standing in front of a case on a table doing this.
I've done it before, and it is quite difficult.
Yeah. It's, but if you can do it well, then yeah, go for it.
Yeah. It's fun because a lot of people really like watching PC builds live. They really do. Mm-hmm. And so I don't mind it at all. I've done two of them so far. I'm going to be doing another one eventually. And it's fun. Like, you get to see the frustrations that you come across when you do a build, because no build ever goes smoothly ever.
Well, and that's where I think a lot of people would want to do it, like, would not want to do it live, right? Because, oh, damn, I forgot this thing. Like, I'm even proud of Paul and those guys for doing time lapses. I'm like, if you've time lapsed me doing a computer, you'd see me like, what the hell happened? You know, it's like, oh, crap, I forgot that screwdriver. I'm doing this. You know, of course, this cable's just this much too damn short, you know, but...
I have a love-hate relationship with time-lapse. Because time-lapse is really... It's really good for videos. People like time-lapse. But it's just like... It's when you can't figure something out and they see you standing in there, and like when you watch a time lapse, if you're standing one place for a couple seconds, it's not really that bad. But when you think about it, like in real time, you were standing at that one place trying to figure out that one thing for like 30 minutes.
They see you curl up in the fetal position and start rocking back and forth and crying like, oh, what did I do wrong?
Yeah. Taz Dude asked, when a reviewer does a generally negative review on one of your products, does that affect any future products you might want to review to them? We already answered that.
Yeah, but real quick recap, as long as it's objective and not subjective, you're fine. As long as it's based on fact and not personal opinion, do what you got to do. You don't want to sell out to a company either, because then you lose your audience.
Yeah, like I said, if you open the case and a 5 1/4 bay falls or something, or you get no, what'd you say, motherboard mounts?
Yeah, no standoff, something like that. I mean, you know, call it out. But
here's a good question. For features like already pre-installed motherboard mounts, motherboard screws, and like other things like that, what goes into incorporating that into a case? Like, how much R&D does that take? How much time and effort would it cost to, like, let's say you had a case that didn't have it and you wanted to implement that into like the next revision of that case?
There are multiple processes to it. It all kind of depends on whether it is, a material cost, a production cost. What you look at sometimes is when people are saying like, oh, how come this didn't bend this way? Or they should have done this, they should have done that. Or if it just bent like this, it'd be so much better. A lot of times, the process of bending metal costs you money. Based on the tooling in the factory, or if that is another additional step in the assembly line. I mean, when you hear assembly line, it's not always like, okay, it goes down this long conveyor belt and 87 things happen to it and it's done. It might go down here, move to this section, go down here. And if you're transporting that around the factory doing that, each time you add a human interaction step, it's additional cost. So, you know, it's like, okay, well, to add these three bends might add $3 to the final cost of the case because the labor now is so much higher to make those happen. You'll see things that you would think are minuscule getting left off of lower-end products, like, you know, the grommets and stuff like that. It might be something where the grommets are not the expensive part. It's paying somebody to put them in. Mm-hmm. You know, it's weird stuff like that. So there's no exact formula for this thing equals this amount, because it's all based on the design of that case and how that case is built. So it's kind of like, I guess the way to look at it is, you know, how much does it cost to at a swimming pool. It's like, well, it depends on the size of your house. Is it indoor, outdoor, above ground, in ground? It's all kind of situational.
Mm-hmm.
So,
nice. Good to know. All right. So I'm saying we take a quick little break. We're not ending the stream at all. Let's take a quick little break. Let everyone go get a drink or whatever, and we will return momentarily.
Yeah, because you know what? I should probably give away something tonight, don't you think?
I think we should. I think maybe when we come back, I think Josh might give something away. Maybe. I mean, if we have enough people in here, I mean, we're not gonna give it away to just like whoever's in here right now, right?
Yeah, I'm gonna give away those pictures of Paul's Hardware I have from CES. You know, the hot tub pictures. So,
all right. Cool. So we'll reconvene
shortly.
When we come back, normally I would put music on, but I don't want the YouTube video to get striked or whatever. So when we come back, we'll think about giving something away. See how many people we can get in here. If we can get a ton of people in here, then I think Josh will be willing to give something away. So, we will be back.
A new car!
A new car, yeah. We will be back momentarily. Hi. All right, so we are back. After that short little break, I went to go stuff my face with a little more food because I was quite hungry. So, before we get into the really good things real quick, how are you guys enjoying this, by the way? I want to know how everyone here is enjoying this chat. I know a lot of people.
This monologue that I've been doing.
Yeah, I know a lot of people were saying before that they like how transparent you're being, because a lot of people would not really do this kind of thing because it's very. It could have gone either ways. People could have been like total dicks about tonight.
Yeah. Yeah.
So. I want to know. It's awesome. Smiley face. Good stream. They like it a lot. Love it. There is a mic echoing. How? Where? Where is our mic echoing? Informative. Nice. Okay. Love this kind of stream. Cool.
Okay.
Nice.
Good.
Maybe we'll do this more often. Who knows?
There we go. Just feel bad for keeping you guys so long, so we can kind of start to wind it down if you guys want to. But maybe. Should we give something away?
He's like, God, we've been keeping these people, we've been stringing these guys along for 2.5 hours. I'm like, oh, they don't mind.
Yeah, tonight when we start, I'm like, I don't know, maybe we'll go like a half hour, 45 minutes, so.
What I want to know is for the people that came in here to pick Josh's brain, okay, and learn something, did this actually help you? Did you actually learn something? That's what I know I did, but I want to know about everybody else. This is very informative, outstanding. It's great info. Good. As long as we can help someone and make it that much easier for them to contact that, you know, whether it's Fractal Design or any other company, doesn't really matter. As long as we could help out and all that, by the way, this is all Josh's idea. This is Josh doing. This is his whole idea. So that way, if it crashed and burned, I could just blame him.
Yes, I don't know why the hell he was doing that.
Oh, yeah. And Paul postponed his stream to be here. And I'm sorry about that, Paul.
I'm crushing him. I'm sorry, man. I'm sorry about that.
I love you so much, Paul. You know how much I love you, man. So, everyone, if you are here from anywhere else, go hit Paul up. I am apropos.
And I'm going to go ahead and drop one of these in the chat.
There you go.
A-bomb action.
But yeah, I think this kind of a live stream, this kind of dialogue helps everyone. I know Paul definitely takes something away from this. I know I did. But
yeah, I think it's definitely a difficult thing to get into. It's a hard thing to understand without having experience in it. And it's that chicken v egg thing of, well, how do I get experience if I can't get in the industry? Well, I can't get in the industry because I don't have experience. You know, I stumbled through a lot of it myself, so. Mm-hmm. You know, if anybody's appreciating this, I'd say, yeah, definitely give Greek a follow. You know, he's obviously been good to me. He's let me hijack his stream for 2.5 hours. So.
Oh, someone asked before. Someone was like, how did you and Greek hook up? I wanted to be like in a bathroom somewhere.
Yeah. Let's back that up there with the hookup thing. Honestly, how was it? I think probably through Paul. I'm apropos.
Like, yeah, we met in Paul's chat.
He's throwing around A-bombs like a drunken sailor.
Whoa. You somehow found your way into my chat, and then Sniper Elite 3 came along.
Yeah, and then we bonded. You know, and I think, for me, one of the things you can tell, too, is, like, if you look at the Twitch streamers that I follow, is I tend to kind of hop around. Like, you know, Paul's new rating thing is definitely helping a lot with, you know, growing the community and also experiencing people to, you know, or getting people to experience a lot of other streamers. Because otherwise, you know, it's this overload of information. Like, I want to follow somebody on Twitch. Who? Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, so many people out there. And I've been in some of the big streams. And I work with some of the larger streamers. Like, some of the guys are like 70,000 subs. Yeah. And it's like, their chat just goes by like that. I'm like, you can't even interact. I'm back to, like, watching a TV show. So I very much follow the Twitch people that I do for the personality as opposed to what game they're playing. So...
Yep, and we were talking about that yesterday, actually.
Yeah, and it's the same type of thing, too, I think, for reviews, and this is where it's kind of hard, because Greek and I have been talking about this, and Gary as well, for the past few days. You know, the last thing that YouTube needs is another tech reviewer that's the same as somebody else.
Oh, yeah.
Now, on the flip side, if you look at my launch day, Define R5 reviews, and, you know, I had Linus, Logan, you know, Hardware Canucks, I had... you know, Paul and Kyle and Jay and all those guys. It's like I'm at over, you know, 500,000 combined views on those. It's like, and I know there's a lot of audience overlap there. It's a Venn diagram, right, where there's that common space in the middle. And I know there are people that watch more than one Define R5 review, just like they would do on a GTX 980 or the new Titan X, because you're watching for the personality. It's like, what does Logan think about this? What does Dimitri or Eber think about this? What, you know, so you're kind of doing it to get their perspective on it. So that's what you really want to have. You want to have an identity when you do a YouTube channel or anything public facing, because that's what sets you apart from the other people. Like, give them a reason to follow you. And if you're passionate about what you're doing, you know, then that's going to show through, and that's going to be somewhat contagious. So, you know, whereas you might have one website that's very dry and one that's very humorous and one that's somewhere in the middle, you might read all three to get those different perspectives on it.
That is true. That is very true, and everyone will bring up different things over the same product. I mean, if it's a graphics card, it's kind of difficult because all graphics cards are always different. But someone always bring up something different in every single review that you watch, and you'd be like, oh, okay.
When you get more eyes on something, someone's going to see it that somebody else didn't, or they might have a different idea for how to use said thing. So,
So I see you have these two questions from Twitter. Did you ask the first one? Did you ask the second one?
Yeah, the second one, it looks like Andre De Jesus was saying, where are the T12, S24, and S36? When are they coming to the U.S.?
That's a great question.
Right now, they're not. So right now, we're basically we're in a wait-and-see mode right now. And I can tell you that we're going to wait and see. Not trying to call anybody out, but right now it just doesn't make sense until we figure out what the overall climate is. I'm sure most of you guys know that there are companies out there that have introduced patents, and, you know, anytime you look at something that could get you dragged into court, 9 times out of 10, it's just not even worth going into court over it. Mm-hmm. So we'll keep an eye on the ecosystem, blah, blah, blah. But believe me, if they do come to the U.S., if you're following me on Twitter or if you're following our Facebook or anything like that, you'll know pretty much right away, because we'll be screaming it out loud. So
D33 G33. Yay, finally a plus of being in Australia.
Except somehow in Australia our products would find a way to kill you, just like everything else.
Exactly. Everything will kill you. Oh my god, I saw a video. This is completely off topic. I saw a video of this guy he was in a hotel room in Australia, and he flushes the toilet and this giant like spider about this big falls down from the inside of the toilet. I'm just like, So if I ever go to Australia, I'm never pooping, ever. Just never gonna happen at all, because everything will kill you.
And I hate spiders, so maybe I'll just fly over Australia and wave, but you know, it's all good. Let's do one giveaway.
We'll do this.
You know how to administer it.
Yeah, for the first giveaway, because Josh, since this stream is mainly about reviewers and people that want to review product, this first giveaway will be strictly for people that want to review a product. Okay. Let me just open up a Nightbot real quick.
So like your chance at a, you know, your first review sample.
Exactly. So,
and this is worldwide. I'll ship anywhere.
This is worldwide. It can be any Fractal product that you want to review. So think wisely. Choose wisely.
Which could be one of the Kelvin units if you're in North America. So.
Oh, wow. Wow. That's pretty, that is pretty, pretty awesome. I'm looking for, hold on a second. Raffle. Okay. Okie dokie. All right. So we're going to do a keyword. Now, the keyword that you're going to have to put in is going to be this. Hold on. Oh, wow. I'm an idiot. Not that.
Dropping the Kelvin bomb. Boom. But it's a very flexible and well-cooling bomb, is all I'm
going
to say.
That is true. All right, so the keyword is going to be review. So, we'll do this.
You are full of riddles, Greg.
I know. Hold on. Type in. Oh, God.
Words are hard.
I know. Type in the keyword !! review to be entered into the raffle.
Sweet. So we'll give that some time and we can talk about some stuff while they do that real fast. Let me just double check my little outline here to make sure I wasn't forgetting anything. One other thing, this probably goes without saying, but the more expensive and highly sought after a product is, the less likelihood you're going to get it. So Whenever the new graphics cards come out, people are like, oh, come on. It's like graphics cards are hot freaking commodity. Getting those are tough. And I know Paul and Kyle, I'm sure, can attest to like having to share stuff with your local reviewers. Like one person might get it. It's like, here, man, borrow it tonight. Do your review quick and get it back. So again, expect to get rejected. Just have your own plan for like, okay, picking up and moving on. And then, like I said, follow back up with people. You know, I'm not going to track you down to see if you grew or if your camera angles got better or whatever. So just make sure that, you know, if you want to be in it, it's going to be hard work, whether it's written or whether it's video.
Mm-hmm. Now I just hope that this works.
Yeah, exactly. No, it's not going to work. Damn it.
I hope this works because I've never done it this way before, so. Hopefully it works.
Okay. Now you tell me.
I know, right?
Not to go all Oprah. Everybody gets a case.
Everybody gets a case. Oh, God.
That would be depressing for me.
All right.
Oh, Rage has been AFK. I bet he's been taking a freaking shower.
Well, that's okay. Okay, I had to fix something before, so we're doing it again. Type in !! review. There you go. Now we're good.
This is a dry run, making sure everybody knew how to do it.
All right. One more time.
One more time. Come on. Okay. Oh, so while we're doing that, I guess it's another thing. Like, I know that a couple other people had mentioned this. My intent was just to do this once, this whole, I guess, live stream. Mm-hmm. Is this something that you guys would want to see more of? I mean, I don't think this really probably warrants like a weekly thing, and there's enough weekly streams out there. Thing. But at least this is something you guys like to see me like once a month or once a quarter or something like that. I mean, if so, you know, hit me up on Twitter. Probably the easiest way for me to track it. I'm at Fractal Josh, and you can also, you know, at Greek on it. But I kind of like more of the behind the scenes look at the industry. I think a lot of people can benefit from that better when they understand how it works. If you understand what my motivation is, you know how to better approach me, just like if I understand your motivation. So
yeah, I agree. That'd be
cool.
All right, so we have two more minutes left on the actual And wait, someone said, if I could add something, motherboards might be a lot easier to obtain. Newegg sent me 3 Z97 motherboards. One of them, Gigabyte G1 Gaming. Nice. Very, very nice. Gotta love that. Yes. People would love, yes, do it, yes. Would love to see more of these, for sure.
Okay, cool.
You always do the same subject. Would you always do the same subject? That's a good question.
I wouldn't think I'd need to. Yeah. I mean, I think that we're going to kind of archive this to hopefully...
So people can look back on this and find out real answers.
Yeah, exactly. They can comb through all the BS I've been saying. Yeah, that's a good idea. Straw poll it. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think it would be something where we can maybe tackle different topics. Mm-hmm. So... maybe have different people on. I mean, like I said, I'm not looking to do like a pimp my vendor. There we go.
Pimp my vendor. I like that.
Yeah. Honestly, I don't think it's I don't think it needs to be a weekly thing. I mean, I don't want to try and trample on everybody else who has weekly shows. Mm-hmm. So
yeah, we can do it every so often.
Yeah.
Not a problem.
Get some other reviewers in here, get their mentality from it, like Paul,
exactly,
Kyle.
Exactly, yep.
Dimitri and Eber. Screw Linus. He doesn't even know how it works. Screw.
He doesn't even know how to review stuff anymore. Sell out.
Damn it.
All right. So we got 26 seconds left on the... if you want to win a Fractal Design product and you want to review it, just type in !review. And obviously, let's just say this real quick. If you win this, Josh will be kind of expecting a video, you know, because this is mainly for people that want to... review a product. If you're that one person that just wants to start reviewing something and you don't have anything to review, this is a perfect way to do it.
So. Yeah, and here's the thing. So basically, in case this gets lost in the deal here, what you'll do is after that, I should be logged into the chat. Just PM me on Twitch. Yeah, just PM me with like, hey, it's me, blah blah blah, and you know what you'd like to review, and then we'll follow up from there.
Yep.
So for some reason, my Twitch stream, like my Twitch messaging, sucks sometimes. So if you haven't heard back from me,
that's just Twitch messaging. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, yeah, it like puts all my inbox stuff in my other box, mm-hmm. whatever. If you don't hear from me within a day, then just ping me on Twitter. So.
Alrighty, so we are gonna pick a winner. We had 39 people enter to win. Sometimes when Greek talks, he sounds like he's doing his best Shatner. Yeah, sometimes I get tongue-tied. It's all right. All right.
All right. Yes, so, unnamed gamer, viewer, video, article, whatever type of review you do.
Yeah.
So.
Alrighty. So the... Oh, my God. That would suck if the stream just went down.
Rig.
The winner is nobody. Okay, great. I'm just waiting for it to stop buffering, piece of shit. All right. Okay, so the winner is Death Scythe Rules. He is following the stream, which is nice, since March 3rd, which is yesterday.
Boom, ahead of the game.
So, Death Scythe Rules, you are the winner. Type something in chat so I know that you can see this. BRB going to cry. And wait, don't leave yet. Don't leave yet.
Yeah, I don't want...
There you go.
Yeah, I don't want to do that. I don't want to hurt people's feelings. Cool. Well, Death Scythe Rules.
See, he never wins anything, and he just won something. So everyone,
see?
Let's give Death Scythe some love.
Yeah, let's give him some congrats.
Congrats to Death Scythe.
Congrats. Now I'm going to start giving away other people's stuff. I'm going to go ahead and give away Paul's hardware. I'm going to give away his case. His home address is blah, 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 blah.
So, Death Scythe, make sure you message Fractal Josh on Twitch. Mm-hmm. Give him your information so he can send you out the case.
And since I kept you guys here so long, I think it's only fair if we do another one for everybody. So there we go. This is, if you want to review it, go ahead and review it. If you don't, you just want to use it. Use it. So
let's see.
It'll be the same thing. It'll be any of the products that we have. And
international.
Let's
see. What's the keyword gonna be? Okay, I got it.
The password is tater hole. Tater hole.
Tater hole.
Took you a bit there. Greek processing.
Oh, God. All right. So, here we go. The keyword is best stream ever.
Hey, you're getting into marketing now.
I know, right?
So, I just want to thank you guys for taking the time to, I guess, listen to me talk for a while. Like I said, I hope you guys find it beneficial. I would be totally down for doing more of these in the future if we kind of, you know, come up with questions or something like that. Password is butt nugget. Cell processing's got it. He's got it, man.
He wins automatically.
He just wins based on merit.
He just wins.
He's just so awesome like that. All
right, so let's see how many people are in chat right now. There are 98 people in chat. I want to see 98 entries. Even the guy that won before, I want to see 98 entries.
Let me go ahead and just enter right here.
Yeah, it'd be funny as hell. And the winner is Fractal.
Yay! What up? Yeah.
Son of a bitch.
It's only two. Man, he won both of them.
He won He's so all generous. Of them.
I start grabbing stuff. Oh, this laptop. We'll give this away.
You grab the Puget box. You're like, no, actually, no, I'm keeping that.
Yeah, that one I got to keep. That one's about 5K, so 4 or 5K.
Oh, God. And they still haven't asked for it back yet, huh?
No, and I want to take... That's the one that has a 980 Strix in it, and then its sister system over here has a 980 Strix in it. And I was like, I should just pull both those out and slap them in SLI in my rig so I can do some 4K game. You should
definitely do that, yeah. Definitely.
I'm like, I know the second I do that, I'll get an email from John. Mm-hmm. Hey, yeah, we just remembered that...
Oh, by the way, you have to be following the stream. I don't know if I mentioned that before. Whoever won before, he was following the stream. But if you're not following the stream and you win this, you will not be eligible.
They follow now?
They can follow now until the giveaway is over, until everyone finishes entering. So you have 2 minutes from now to enter !! Best stream ever. And you need to be following the stream to do so.
YouTube asks, are these Mayflower headphones? Yes, they are.
There you go. So,
yeah, because I met Tyler when I did the road trip with Logan and Jimmy when we gave away the car. So
nice.
I'm just giving stuff away left and right.
Very, very nice.
Very nice.
So we got 100 people in here right now. That is the most I've ever had. Well, before cool. was the most. Actually, what was the most we've had in here tonight? Info. The max was 118.
Really?
Yeah, 118. That is the most I've ever had in here.
Usually tell me people are running away from me.
That's a lot. It's a lot of people.
Let's hear. In the meantime, Whaler said, can we send Josh links to some things we have posted on a forum for him to look at and give criticism? I'm sure you can send it to me. Honestly, I'll get to it as I have time. Criticism... I mean, it just kind of depends if you want me to, like, rate your system or if you're wanting for, like, I guess critiques on the build log. Yeah, sure. Like I said, it might take me some time to get to it. But.
Mm-hmm. So let's see. How many followers have you gotten tonight? I have gotten, I should say it right on there, I've gotten 51 followers tonight. Wow. Jesus.
Nice.
Now 52. All right, you got 30 seconds left to join. But when you see this, it's probably going to be like 10 seconds left.
And done.
And done. Oh, yeah. Keyword raffle closing in 30 seconds. There you go.
Tickety-tocky.
Mm-hmm. How do you want it spelt?
I think legitimate, right? Like the exact way you type it.
Exactly the way you type it.
Yeah. Reviews by Gary's going to win. And then you're like, oh, I want that white R4. And then return the one he just bought.
And that's it. 63 viewers have entered.
Nice.
But only one will win.
It's now the steel cage match of giveaways.
This is exactly. All right. So. Okay. So, again, we said this is going to be for any Fractal product.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to review it if you don't want to, which is fine. You have to be following the stream, naturally. And I just, that's so funny. When I said you'd be following the stream, all of a sudden the notification just pop up, people following. All right.
How would you?
So, now we draw the winner. And the winner is, I kind of want to be someone that I know. I kind of want
you,
to be.
You don't have any friends. I don't know.
I know, right? Be. I should have entered this just because.
You should have. Can I get something?
All right. And the winner is, what is
Kalili?
That? Kalili. Kalili. With a 1.6 chance of winning. And Kalili is following since today.
There you go. Oh, Swashin's going to cry again. He's going to go lay down on his vertical height adjusting.
Yes, Kalili, you have won, and you are following the stream, so thank you so much.
Yes, congrats. Congrats.
You are following the stream. Are you?
Are you?
I must find out.
Replied. Said, really? The click, 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 click. Yeah. So, yep, same thing applies. Just message me, PM me through Twitch. I keep pointing that way because it's on my 4K
yeah,
over
exactly.
here. So. Twitch is over down the hall.
Kalili, you have won any any Fractal product that you want. Make sure that you message Fractal Josh on Twitch ASAP so that way he can get that out to you. So that's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. So congrats to all the winners. Congrats to everybody that's hanging out and all that good stuff. And just as another thing, if you guys, whenever you guys receive whatever it is that you chose from Fractal Josh, whenever you receive it, take a picture of it and tweet at me and Fractal Josh so that way we can, you know, retweet it and Fractal Josh can get some sort of joy in his life. to seeing you being happy with whatever that product is. So,
yes, exactly. That's what I search for. That's what I live for. Otherwise, I have to hang out with Greek, and that's just, well, as you can imagine, it's not good.
Yeah, that's true. It's not good. So, but I think that's it, right? I think we're done for now.
Yeah, I think we're done. I've got to go. I got kids that I got to go kiss goodnight. They are mine. So we're
surprisingly
okay
enough.
Yes, exactly. I thank you guys for hanging out for so long. I didn't mean to keep you guys for so long. It's Yeah, because I saw Listfiskern. John, he popped in. He's like, I can't believe you guys have been at it for almost 3 hours.
Oh yes. God.
Yeah, we have. Holy crap. Yep. So cool, epically long stream. I hope it was advantageous to you guys that watched and to you ladies. Greek, are you still going to stream tonight? You probably going to stay on in game or something?
I will close the stream for a little bit, and then I will restart it back up again because I will game. What are we going to play tonight if that's the case? Then?
Tell you what. I got to do like the take care kids stuff. I'll probably be offline for maybe 40 minutes or so, 45. Let's just say I might be offline for about an hour. Go ahead and do your stream. I'll try and hop back in. Maybe we can do some Sniper Elite. We can do like one of the survival ones or something
like
that.
We can do many of those, yeah.
Yeah, we can do some of that stuff. So if you guys want to check us out gaming, we'll be gaming later. I know I'm Apropos said that he's out for the night. I appreciate him basically postponing his stream. So thank you guys. Your support's pretty awesome. And I look forward to seeing you again. Oh, and by the way, if I'm going to take a chance to plug myself, I'm going to start streaming pretty soon.
Oh,
that's
yeah.
That's right. You'll be able to get to see horrible gameplay.
Horrible gameplay.
This guy.
You thought mine is bad. You should see his.
Yes, you'll see the true president of Derpistan is going to come out and just all over the place screw this up. So like I said, obviously, hit me up. I look forward to interacting with you guys more. And like I said, if you have questions, save them up, and maybe we'll come out with the look in the next few days over Twitter.
Oh, yeah.
And maybe I'll just keep like that Ask FD Josh, or we'll just keep something going so we can kind of catalog the questions, maybe develop the next show around it or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So I'm glad you guys enjoyed. This was a lot of fun. Really a lot of fun. I'm glad everyone had a good time. I'm glad everyone learned and got answers to the question that they've been meaning to ask for such a long time. And sorry for the lag. My internet's weird tonight. So, but other than that, I'm glad you guys enjoyed. And from me and Fractal Josh, we will see you
Oh, and one last thing. Greek is planning on basically putting the archive of this up on his YouTube channel. So if you came in late, you had to leave early, something like that.
Exactly.
Just follow Greek, basically. What's your YouTube?
It's the same thing. My YouTube and my Twitch are the same thing. So either Greek on YouTube, either Greek on Twitch, either Greek on Twitter, Instagram, you name it. It's just either Greek.
So, yep, so it'll be up in the next few days, right?
Exactly. It'll be up in the next few days. So that way, if you guys want to watch it, and luckily that way there won't be any lag
on
that end, because it's directly to my hard drive, so that's good. But yeah, so like I said, it's been fun.
Peace out, everybody. Thank you for coming.
Have a good night, everybody, and we will see you next time. Bye. Yeah.